A night in with Mauler and the drinker. Getting trashed with the web screen ninjas. A cheap night cause I'm feeling kinda thrifty. Got a 10 pack of beers and a bottle of whiskey. Hop off the cork, have a glass of wine. Pass fail safe. Trouble walking in a straight line. Look for the Pinot Noir. It's open bar with our hosts, Mauler and the Critical Drinker.
All right. Hello. Are you ready for the power of two?
No.
We're gonna
power many, drinker. Power many's way better. Power many's so good, Trinity can defeat it.
I know. I'm still trying to puzzle that one out, to be honest. It was quite an interesting...
I think the show is awful, and it doesn't make any sense, and they didn't think about anything they were saying or doing. Crazy.
I would say there's a distinctly strong possibility you're right on that one, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, don't worry. We'll get into that soon enough. Believe that. But first up, well, welcome everyone to Open Bar. This is Open Bar number 103. And you know, it's an interesting one because it's just occurred to me that I didn't actually bother to research any facts about 2003 for today, which
2002
really
one as well.
Yeah, well, that was Independence Day, so I gave you a whole bunch of facts
about
Independence Day. So I actually did put quite a lot of research into that one.
Yeah.
I will hit you at the very least with the top movies of 2003. So you've at least got something.
Sure.
So in terms of worldwide box office, mm-hmm. I think we know which one was the biggest of that year. It's the little movie you might have heard of called Return of the King.
That did 1.1, wasn't it?
Yeah,
nice.
Yeah, Return of the Jedi King.
Yeah,
that did 1.1 billion worldwide, which is funny because in today's money, that's not even that much for a modern day movie. But yeah, that was the king of the box office in 2003. In second place, there was Finding Nemo, and then third place, The Matrix Reloaded. Remember them? Remember the Matrix movies? That was funny. Then Pirates of the Caribbean, The Curse of the Black Pearl, and then Bruce Almighty was in fifth place. So that must have been one of Jim Carrey's biggest movies, actually.
That is a fun selection of films right there.
Yeah. It was also the year that gave us The Last Samurai, The Matrix Revolutions later in the year, X-Men, X2, sorry.
Ooh.
Good one. Bad Boys 2. Charlie's Angels Full Throttle, you know, swings and roundabouts and all that. Hulk as well, the Ang Lee version. That was that was a blast from the past. Scary Movie 3. Elf came out in 2003. Everyone's
good
favorite
old movie. Elf.
Also Daredevil, you know. That taught Ben Affleck never to play superheroes. I'm glad he stuck to that. So.
He's like, you know what? One more try. Let's see if this works. Oh, it doesn't.
Like, oh man, not again. But yeah, it was not a bad year. I wish I had more time to research all of the other movies that came out that year. We did have The Core, which was absolutely epic. You know, I've got lots of fond memories of that one. And also, what's that other one that I saw? Yeah, Big Fish. I've got a soft spot for Big Fish. I quite like that one.
Tim Burton's a movie, right?
Yeah. Ewan McGregor and Albert Finney, I think.
Hmm.
Yeah, it was a heartwarming little movie. I like that one. Anyway, so that's the extent of my knowledge on 2003, I'm afraid, since I totally let you guys down, and I apologize for that.
Yeah.
You know what? I'm gonna improve myself and I'm gonna do better next week. But anyway, we have got a panel of guests this evening. We're still waiting, actually, for Theory and Tyrone to join us. But fortunately, we do have the wonderful Baggage Claim. So welcome back to Open Bar. It's great to have you back.
Thank you. It's good to be back. I'm glad you guys talked about Return of the King, because my favorite scene in that movie is when Aragorn comes into the room and says, "Somehow Sauron returned."
It's so classic. It's, you know what, Tolkien had it nailed, and Star Wars could only emulate dialogue of that quality.
Love the idea that Gandalf's like, "Somehow we have a whole ass prologue to tell you how we explained this thoroughly. What do you mean?" Like, I don't know, man. Sith magic.
Somehow.
Dark ring magic.
Yeah.
I'm also very excited to talk about Acolyte. So pull on some threads on that one.
We all are. I think we should probably just launch right into then. I'm sure Tyrone and Theory will join us and they'll be eager to talk about it as well. But yeah, you guys, on a scale of 1 to 10, how horrific was this episode? I feel like we do this every week now.
Oh, so at the beginning, we were speculating on the fact that several people had said that it's the worst one, me and my old crew, and we were like, nah, it'll be bad, but like, is this really going to be episode 3 style? When we hit the credits, and I very much mean hit the credits for specific reasons we'll talk about later, we were like, shit, that's the worst one. Like, it's just, it just is. The writing of this is so horrifically awful, and it affects the whole season. This is the episode we were all waiting for answers, and we've got them now.
I mean, it was 50% rehashed storyline anyway.
Yep.
I think that's being generous, actually. It's probably closer to 80%.
I mean, yeah, I said about 50%, and like when I was trying to tally up like all of the scenes that they just replayed from a different camera angle, and it's getting into the sort of 50-50 realm, which is unbelievably lazy. You know, that is just how you eat up time. I feel like this whole episode could have been like a 3-minute flashback to get the key points across. You didn't need to rehash everything that we saw in episode 3 to set the stage for this. It's not that complicated. And that's just the beginning of the problems. And that's not even mentioning the absolutely horrific dialogue, the nonsensical character decisions. Even the way the episode opens when everyone's just like walking around, scanning plants with a Wookiee with a metal detector. That's something I never expected to see in Star Wars. And then they've been there for almost 2 months. Ugh. And Torben is like, so why are we here? I don't understand.
Oh, God.
And what have you been doing all this time? I want to go home. That's it. No other explanation. Just so I want to go home.
They're picking up random pieces of grass and putting it into a box and just pressing buttons. I was like, who the fuck wrote this? What? They got a Wookiee with a metal detector. I thought that was so funny.
Put it into the moss machine. Oh, actually, wait, before
and the machine says, yes, this is moss.
This is moss.
High level of moss detected here. We're just talking about moss theory. How do you feel about the moss scanning that went on in this?
Oh, it was great. I think they were trying to find the plot.
They still couldn't find it. I did like the fact that Trinity carried our moss, which just seemed very appropriate. You know, everyone made the joke.
Good old Carrie.
I know.
I'm still trying to get over her, how she threw the Wookiee on the ground.
Oh, we'll get that. Don't worry. I love how Torben, right, because we were just talking about this, how he doesn't actually understand why he's there, even though he's been there for 3 months now.
They didn't explain it to him for 7 weeks.
Do you think this was some kind of test for him? It's like, we're going to test your initiative. Just like, how long will he go before he asks why he's here?
They're like on the ship, leaving Carson. He's like, why are we doing this? And they just look at him like, not going to tell you.
Figure it out. It's like,
and then he doesn't understand.
It's like a Where's Waldo puzzle. It's like, you got to figure it out for yourself.
I mean, I'm no military man, right? But I'm pretty sure when you send people off to do things, you give them a briefing, which tells them what their objective is. Nah. So they know why they're there. I know. Check me out with my crazy military lingo, but that's my understanding at least.
Information. Intel. What are those?
Well, what was confusing was that he didn't understand the whole virgins thing, and then all of a sudden he's like, well, they're like, you need to go home. The council says go home. And then he's like, we have to go kidnap the kids so that we can prove to the council that they are important and we can come home. Like, they literally just said go home. Why are you doing this?
Well, the thing is, they contact the council. Council say don't interfere with this cult. And then they discover the symbionts thing. Tell the council about that.
Yeah.
But they don't. He's just like, yeah, let's go kidnap some kids. And the other three very powerful Jedi are like, no, don't go. No, we can't stop you with the Force. No.
Why does he have the attitude as well of like a Vietnam soldier or something like who just like wants to get out of this hellhole and go home to be with, you know, his family again? Because it's like, you're just on a boring planet, like scanning moss. Okay, it's not like the most thrilling thing in the world, but like, it's not traumatic. Like, that shouldn't be some deep-seated trauma that someone can use against you later in the episode. Hint, hint.
Yeah. So It's funny you say that. Like the nature of this whole thing, I thought was going to provide us that Torbin, his fuck up, right? The reason he wants to kill himself. I was like, okay, finally we're getting it. The core trait isn't even, I want to go back to Coruscant for something, something important, something core. I would have thought Star Wars universe, he's got like a problem of attachments that he hasn't properly sorted out yet. Maybe he's got family back there and that he's like, I don't know, it's been too long. Just anything you can try to work with. All they say is he's homesick and that is it. There's nothing about anyone he loves. All he even says is Coruscant, the planet. Yeah. Not even a place on the planet.
Maybe he's just really, like, he's got a takeaway there that he really likes and he just wants to get back to it or something.
We all have to speculate on it because we're like, where's the character of this character? He just wants to go to planet. And then the bigger problem is for me is that they use that to make him speed off. It's like, oh gosh, he's gonna run himself into some trouble. But he doesn't. He arrives and he's like, I can't get in. And then Sol's like, okay, follow me.
Climb up the entire mountain.
Climb the tower.
Yeah. I mean, like, because Anasea, like the idea of you know, getting inside someone's head, using their deepest fears and insecurities or whatever against them as a way to manipulate them, that's not bad. Like, it's been done a million times before, but it's perfectly serviceable as a plot device. But there needs to be something that you can grapple with there. Like, if he's got like a dying mother or something back home, or something that he needs to get to, or some deep regret or something that he needs to fix. But it is literally, as you said, MauLer, he just kind of wants to go back to Coruscant because he likes it more than here. Because it's, that's not enough.
Then, if we're doing him first, just he didn't do anything wrong from then on. He went in because the kids are unsafe, and then he's threatened by someone with a big old staff, and then he's attacked by a volley of arrows, and then he's attacked by a mind-controlled Wookiee, and he's wounded. Yeah. He did nothing wrong.
Yeah, so like all all the posts on Twitter have been like, so why did he kill himself again? Like, what is he trying to atone for?
Yeah.
He's probably the least guilty out of all of them. Or maybe the Wookiee, actually, because he essentially did nothing throughout the
This is what you say, the least is like, the most guilty would be Sol, but should he be guilty whatsoever? I think no.
Well, no.
There's a good turned question into here. A demon.
Yeah. Oh, I'll get to that. Don't worry. Why is a Padawan on this mission? Why are any of them on this mission initially anyway? Because like at first, this does not seem like a high priority mission. It's literally just a planet where there was a big disaster like 100 years ago and it should be barren of life, but it's like a thriving...
Vergence, right?
Yeah, so they reckon there's a vergence there, or it could just be an ecosystem that recovered. Who knows? But like... Your solution is that you have to scan methodically all the moss on the planet.
Yeah,
just deploy a shit ton of probe droids, let them do their work, and if they find something interesting, then they can signal you, and then you send people there, like Jedis and stuff. Why would you send a squad of Jedi, the most elite warriors in the galaxy, to do such a mundane task? It's absurd.
Do you remember when we discussed episode 3, we were talking about how weird it was and how brazen Trinity's lie was, where she's like, we didn't know anybody was here. Turns out they didn't know anybody was there. I was like, how is that possible? That building is clearly like, how did you miss that?
Even if you can't see it with your eyes, which is absurd anyway, like it's got a power generator in it. It's got like, it's got lights, it's got scanners, it's got like all kinds of like electrical
concentration of life forms.
Oh yeah, concentration of life forms. All the kind of things that would show up in a cursory scan. Like, this is what you do in Star Wars. You can just scan a planet and it'll tell you if there's life forms, if there's technology, cities, whatever, really quickly. Yeah. Easy.
Right.
Made even worse, Sol bumps into it, going in four random directions on a planet, and he bumps into two children playing next to a tree. Fuck off.
That was lucky.
It's so annoying. Everything.
Don't they have like thermal scanners where they could scan the planet and be like, oh, there's a whole shitload of witches over there.
The script could have accounted for this relatively easy just by saying there's ion storms or something crazy, like, and we can't scan the planet properly, so we're gonna have to go down there manually and do it ourselves. Like, okay, it's goofy and it's pretty contrived, but it's something. It's an explanation for why this stuff doesn't show up. But the writers didn't even think of that. They didn't care. Because none of it matters to them. Like, all this stuff is just not thinking about it at all.
Yeah, back to Torbin's lack of backstory, I mean, the show is really missing meat. It has barely any story to cover anyway. That's why they're rehashing things. You could have used character development to help make this meatier.
Mm-hmm. A love this as well. It's got flammable rock as well. That would have come up on a hazard scan.
Oh, man. This is such fascinating to compare to episode 3's coverage. A lot of people were saying, you know, May, she got mind-controlled more than likely, and the fire wasn't what we thought. We think it's what it is, but it's not what we thought. She wasn't mind-controlled, and the fire was exactly a stone fire. That's what it was.
Well, and then she tries to put out the journal, and then she's like, oh, shit, it's on fire. She's like trying to put it out.
She's like, oh my god, the thing I set on fire is now on fire. Oh no,
oh my god,
predicted this.
Then she stomps on it and it's like, mama.
What was Horn Lady intending to do when she said get angry? What did she want May to do?
That's my
secret, Cap. I'm always angry.
Because it's like saying to a young child, you know, get angry and put yourself in dangerous situations when there's armed Jedi everywhere. Like, that just seems like a pretty bad mother decision. You know,
maybe she has some latent powers when she gets angry. She's like turns into Super Saiyan 2 or something.
I mean, I can get the idea that like these two collectively are a virgins in the Force if you combine them. And so they do have like huge Force powers, but like they're still children. Like, they don't know how to control this stuff. They haven't been trained or anything. So if you just turn them loose and tell them to get angry, like, I feel like that's just kind of a recipe for disaster. Hey, little Jimmy, go and play in that fireworks factory. And here, you know, take this torch with you just in case you can't see properly.
Like, she's rushing out of the room crying, saying, I need help, because she's set the whole building on fire.
I really wouldn't be surprised if Leslie wanted to put the number of the midichlorians in there for it to be higher than Anakin.
Oh, sure.
Oh, yes. Oh,
and they were like, no, we can't do this.
This is the highest, yes. And what I found interesting is that the two moms, it was kind of their character was really mismatched. It's like one of them is very aggressive, one of them is very lenient. And the aggressive lady, it actually doesn't make sense, because if she's the one who carried these kids, she's going to be a lot more protective and coddling, but they got that wrong. And then later, the one who's more lenient should be the one saying like, hey, do it whatever you want. Whereas the stricter one should be like, hey, be careful, like stay in line, do as I say. So it just, none of that made sense at all.
Yep. No, characterization just kind of goes out the window with this one. I love as well how quickly characters change their minds. Like, you know, when they're first sneaking into the fortress, and it's great because like Saul literally climbs up a vertical mountain. Like, it must have taken him like days to get up there.
Use the force.
But he eventually gets up there and he like sees everything. And then he goes back. I guess he just climbed back down the thing, which is, yeah, sure. Reports back to Trinity and the others, and then they go. And her opinion is like, we shouldn't all go in at the same time, because that's like a show of force and they might misinterpret that. So I'll just go in or something. And he just pretty much says, no, the children could be in danger. And then she's like, okay, fine. I'm convinced. And then they all just go in together anyway. Like,
it's kind of just odd vibes. Like, it feels like they all know more than they should in terms of what they should be worrying about. Instead of, they should all just be like, huh, there's a structure on this planet that has life on it. Let's knock. They don't even try that. They're just like, no, Keldalka, just break in. Yeah. And we'll just go in as a team. It's like, what? I was really confused watching it. I was like, did they ring the doorbell? Is there a doorbell? I don't know.
At least Jabba had a doorbell.
There's no reason to be like antagonistic. It's hello, we visited a planet. Who are you guys? Because remember, in episode 3, they established that these the lesbian space witches have been running from the Jedi, I think. They're trying to escape them. So,
hello, Tyrone.
They're like antagonistic, dude. And so you think to yourself, this will be awkward on their side. But the Jedi don't know that. They have no idea who these people are. So they should just be like, hey, locals, how you doing? I thought there was this world was barren. None of the conversation is like that. It's all really fucking odd and stilted. Like, let us test you. Do you have children? Yeah. And then I will release your Jedi if you leave this place. Like, where, how did we get here?
Even that conversation makes no, like, within a single line, it makes no sense. Where it's like, as Jedi, we have a right to test the children with your permission.
With your permission.
Well then, if you need permission, then you don't have the right, clearly. That's the definition of a right, something you can just do.
Yes.
What's also confusing is how they are able to go to this planet because they can sense a virgins. Qui-Gon couldn't sense any virgins. He just ended up on Tatooine. That was more of the will of the Force versus this is like, they literally sensed it from, well, why didn't Yoda sense it? Did he sense it? Did the council send them there? I don't know.
Or was it just information that the planet had green on it, and they're like, could be a virgin's here. Go have an inspection.
Go, there's life.
It's funny because I can't get over, like, when Saul says it because of his accent, like, it always sounds like he's saying virgin. And he's like, I think they're virgins here.
No, like, no, no.
He's just determined to find his virgins.
No. Oh, my God. Oh, shit.
But it could have been, like, an interesting mystery, right? Is that you have these Jedi come in cold. They can sense something is off. And they come and they just meet this innocuous group of witches. You have no idea what's going on. It could have been, like, unfolded over time, but instead it was just they first of all reveal way too much too quickly, and then they just hammer it in over and over. Yeah. I think even the fact that the two girls, obviously they're played by the same character, that could have been an interesting mystery too, is that one person commits the crime, they have the same haircut, which ridiculous, but the other person is getting charged for it, and you don't know that they're not the same person. So that could have been a slow reveal as well, where you don't know if you can trust this main character, because at one point she's committing murders, at other point she seems to be a good person and claiming that she didn't commit those murders, and then you could reveal to the audience that, oh, she actually has a twin or something. I don't know, some kind of mystery.
That would work better if she wasn't the main character, like if someone like Saul or whatever was the main character, and then you were just seeing her from his perspective, and so makes you don't sense. Necessarily know if you can trust her, you don't know if she's reliable, whatever, and then you can build up a mystery around whether or not she is responsible for it, which I think would be fine. Like you could ask all kinds of questions around that, and then gradually uncover that truth about there being a twin and like all this backstory. But yeah, the whole season is so weirdly front-loaded with information. It essentially tells you everything you need to know within the first couple of episodes, and there's no doubt in your mind, like, yeah, Osha has a twin, and she's the one who's actually the evil one, who's responsible for all this bad stuff, and there's no ambiguity there about who's good and who's bad. And really, like, even this episode, we got that flashback episode in episode 3 that showed us all this stuff that happened. We kind of guessed the little details about the fact that, like, why the rest of the witches got killed and so on. There was nothing particularly new here. There was nothing in terms of revelations that made anyone go, oh, wow, I didn't see that coming. It's pointless. And because the whole season is too front-loaded with obvious information, there's no mystery left.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a...
Barely any story to tell in the 8 episodes. Yeah. It's got the exact same problem Ahsoka had. Kind of the same problem all the shows have.
Is it just like, is it pitched at morons? Is that the idea? It's like, it's going to be on streaming or something. And no, so we just need to keep people's attention by just really obvious stuff.
I honestly think that what happened is, like, you've seen in a few interviews where Leslie is talking about Star Wars, and then the people around her are like, oh my God, she knows so much. She knows, like, this planet doesn't have this person and that shouldn't exist. And this, I think Leslie is probably like someone who watches a little bit of Star Wars YouTube. And so against, like, the normies who don't understand any of it, she's like a god. So she's gone with this, like, yes-men sort of mentality energy and gone and created this show thinking that she really understands Star Wars and the science behind it and the rules, but she doesn't. She doesn't understand anything.
Theory, did you hear her say that she said she wanted to portray the story? It should never be seen as Qui-Gon and Anakin as the only way that a child can be brought into the Jedi, and that we need to understand that that can go multiple ways. And I think... when I was listening to her, I was like, "Is she trying to say that Saul and Osha are like a different Qui-Gon and Anakin, and that look that it can go bad?" And I was thinking to myself, like, "Does she? Did anyone else think it was weird that she missed the part of the prequel, the Phantom Menace, where Qui-Gon got to know Anakin? Do you know what I mean? Like, he's that must have been skipped with Osha, because Saul's like obsessed with her. He stalks the children." And then he says, I feel a connection. She's meant to be my Padawan. And then he shows the lightsaber, but he doesn't know anything about her.
I know.
And he's obsessed with her. I was like, I think you fucked up there. Like, the Qui-Gon gets invested in Anakin with the more that he finds out about him. There's the conversation at the dinner table. He's watching him with the pod race. Yeah. And the pod racer building it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Plus, no, I know. And then he's like, then eventually concludes that he's encountered a virgins in the Force after, like, a long time of knowing Anakin and seeing this boy react in a literal pod race, which no human can do.
I didn't like it at all that his investment in her was entirely how he felt about looking at her and stuff. It's just like, that's not
true. Same with her obsession
would have been like
with the Jedi.
Love at first sight or something if she'd been like an adult.
Like, it's a weird obsession, right?
Yeah.
It's
did you see in that interview, she was like, you know, maybe when it comes time to the Jedi Council training Anakin, they have a problem with it because of the events in this show. Like,
are you fucking kidding? Well, it's too late for that now, because in this episode, Carrie-Anne Moss says she's too old to train.
Yeah.
So that can't be true, even though you're right, she did say that, so I don't get it.
But then he just went, okay. Like, I love as well at the end when she tries to take the moral high ground about, like, wow, okay, we need to just lie to the Jedi Council and tell them that Maeve was responsible for this whole thing. And it's like, do you really want to put this young girl through more heartache when she's already lost so much by, like, subjecting her to a trial? And I thought, like, clearly it's meant to be like, bitch, you're covering your own arse here because you absolutely fucked up on this one. Like, you got a whole bunch of people killed. And you were leading this mission. You're trying to save number one here. But I don't think the writers know that. That's the problem. Like, I think we can read that into her, but I don't think the writers saw that. And they actually think that she's trying to take them the moral high ground on this one. She's actually a good person for wanting to spare Osha that pain.
She didn't spare shit. As far as Osha knows, May, her beloved sister, killed her whole family. As opposed to the truth, which is her night sister cult wannabe people attacked the Jedi. At least that was the interpretation. And they mind controlled the Wookiee to try and kill them. Like, these are aspects of the story that are just like, sorry, Osha, but basically everything went to shit. Like, it's just, it's not. But like, the idea that's like, see, that would be way worse than her knowing May killed everyone. It's like, literally. Why? Is that worse or better? I don't know.
They're trying to draw these parallels between the Jedi and police enforcement issues in America. It's just like,
oh yeah,
the fact that they keep like you know, showing that they're reading their rights. They talk in that first episode, one of the dumbest lines I thought was, someone matched your description, someone said that to Osha. It's like, it's a huge galaxy. No, what, I don't even know, universe. You're telling me that someone matched her description or looked exactly like her, and that's why you're here. But they use that kind of language to drive home, like, oh, look at them. They're these brutal, you know, enforcers. They don't care about life. They're okay with mass murder. Doesn't matter what the other side is doing as aggression at all, which is how they look at police issues as well, is that it doesn't matter that someone's carrying a gun and pointing it at a police officer. If then in the scuffle he gets killed, then that's police brutality, just plain and simple.
I did like this one. Mostly peaceful Sith. Fiery, but mostly peaceful Sith.
Naked.
It's like, naked, but they fail it there as well, like with this episode, because it's like the Jedi are acting for entirely understandable reasons. They see these two girls who are indoctrinated into this, like, from their point of view, like a dark magic force using lesbian death cult, and they're concerned about their welfare. They're worried, like, what they're going to be used for, because this really seems like the kind of place where human sacrifices are done. Mm-hmm. And so their initial attitude is, we should at least test them to see if they are, like, strong in the force, and then maybe we've got a justification for taking them away and giving them proper training. Because correct me if I'm wrong, like, you guys know better than I do, but like, any person within the Star Wars universe who is really strong with the force, who's very strongly force sensitive, if they're not given any training whatsoever, they're kind of a danger to themselves and everyone else around them. Because all it is going to take is for them to get mad one day, and like, they might fucking throw a table across the room without even intending
they
to
might
kill
turn
people.
Turn into a giant smoky demon that possesses people or something. You never know.
And yeah, well, evaporates children.
Oh, sure. But yeah, like, so the whole point being, they need to be shown how to control their powers. Even if they don't become Jedi, they at least need to be shown how to control and understand the power that they have.
Yeah.
And that's why they are able to take these children away, essentially, to give them that grounding. So there's a justifiable reason for it in my view.
Yeah.
Unless I'm going,
interesting.
Unless
I didn't know that. I didn't know that. But that was the other thing also, is that Osha's in obsession with the Jedi didn't really make sense, because if she's living this very sheltered life, she should not really know anything about them. And that could have been an interesting aspect too, is to show her as very committed to this life that she's been taught, because she's been raised in a very specific way. And then she encounters, you know, a different type of understanding of life or whatever, and she realizes she doesn't want to do this, she wants to leave. And when her mom says, oh, she's not gonna, you know, you guys are trying to take her away, whatever, and then when she gets killed, she says, I was going to let her go with you. Why didn't you lead with that? Why didn't you start?
Here we have here. I'm going to show you the clip actually, but just before we do it, like, yeah, you've hit the nail on the head with that one. Osha wants to join the Jedi. She wants to be a Jedi, but she knows nothing about them, and she's got no reason to want to do that. Again, this is the work of a more intelligent script that would have to take a little bit of time. And I guess one of the easy ways you can do that is have the sisterhood be extremely strict and rigid about what the girls are allowed to do, what activities they're allowed to do, how where they're allowed to go, and all that sort of thing. And for the Jedi to show up and say, no, there's other ways that you can approach this. There's a whole galaxy of possibilities out there for you to explore, and we can show you some of that. If you're willing to, you know, trust us or whatever, something, you know, that piques her interest and shows like she is more inclined towards adventure, questioning rules, exploration, that sort of thing. Just take a little bit of time to do it, but they don't. She just wants to be a Jedi for reasons, I guess, and that's all we get. But yeah, the other point you made is like, yeah, I know if I'm in a tense situation, where there's conflict about to break out, fists are about to be thrown or whatever, I know the best thing to do is to turn into a terrifying demon smoke monster, just like they do here. And I actually sped this up to double speed so I could show you all of it.
I was going to let Osha go.
I don't believe you.
Drink, you missed the best part where she like has the demon monster face with the extended. She literally has ghost face for a moment. She extends the jaw.
Oh, there you go, like.
What in the world?
It doesn't look friendly.
No.
Yeah. It's like that moment, you know, in The Simpsons when Homer gets Apu fired from the Quickie Mart, right? And Apu comes around to his house to forgive him, and he comes into the house like, and he tries to explain like, oh, that's a traditional like forgiveness gesture amongst my people back in India. In retrospect, yeah. So many people have died needlessly because
of it. The movie where he tosses the silo into the water and all the horrible pollution shit goes down, then a skull appears and just goes, evil.
Maybe there's something I wasn't understanding, but do you remember when in this scene May comes around the corner and then Sol is like, Osha?
Yeah,
it's like, well, that's not Osha, that's May,
which means he was completely off in his senses.
Yeah,
that's because they're so alike, you see, you can't even tell them apart with the force. But yeah, like, help me understand.
Why did
as
that
well right
off the horn lady though?
See, so Sabine Wren and what's the bint from the Reva? Obi-Wan Kenobi show? Reva, yeah. So they can all tank lightsabers to the chest and it's totally fine, right? This girl turns into a demon monster and, like, she takes one and she's just dead as shit, man.
Oh, by the way.
Game over, man.
That's to appease the fans.
Hold on.
She's not even there. She's just smoke. I just like so
finally they
smoke.
Let them die.
It's like finally,
They do the thing, by the way. They put Horn Lady on pause. She would totally have attacked Sol here immediately.
Yeah.
But she's not allowed to. She's frozen.
But that's what's weird is that why didn't he attack Horn Lady when she was the one who was like actually super aggressive?
Well,
that it made so much more sense.
She did turn into a horrible demon, though.
She turned into a demon. Yeah. Evaporating demon, and then the child started evaporating.
Yeah, they made sure to show us that Sol recognized whatever she was doing was affecting what he believed was Osha.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And it did look like she was actually disintegrating, which I think is... people
probably
make a comparison.
Like, if they're being disintegrated by a smoke demon monster.
Like, all we can conclude, Anasaya, you are a moron for pulling this move in this high tense of a situation with weapons at the ready. You should not have done this.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but no, they'll try and make it Sol's fault.
What would, like, just as a matter of interest, like, if this had played out according to her plan, what would have happened? Would she have vaporized herself and May and just teleported
Ryan
somewhere?
Thought when we were watching it, Ryan said that he thought that it was her sucking Osha or May back into her.
Sucking
What?
Yeah, well, like,
they were gonna just turn into gas, and she was gonna grab her. So I don't know. Like, this is the thing. I don't think anyone knows what the fuck she was gonna
do. What the horn one did earlier, didn't she?
So that's the thing. The horn lady. Right? I actually do assume that she teleported out. like, because I think they're going to bring it back. Like, that's the most obvious thing to do, right? But well, I have nothing to work with. I don't know what that fucking power is.
Oh, yeah. Check this out. Check this out.
Is Horn Lady actually Smilo Ren? Did she just, like...
No, she's probably his master, though.
Hmm.
It would check make some out. Sense, right?
So, in some interview, it was sent to me by a buddy. He says, the interviewer says, "This one's for me. I've been wanting many years for Darth Plagueis to show up. Do you know how the whole story of the galaxy far, far away from the Acolyte to him training Palpatine connects?" Leslie says, "Yes, I do. If I continue to get to tell this story, I know how I would like that to play out, and I would say I think it's pretty complicated and messy." So if we get a season two, she wants to incorporate Plagueis and Palpatine. My God.
Oh, the idea that this is going to get a season
it's
two.
It's going to be more
Palpatine.
Dude, if it gets season two, young Palpatine and Plagueis, they're going to potentially destroy my favorite book. Favorite characters.
I mean,
they will destroy it.
Yeah, like, just accept that they're going to get their claws into it at some point, I suppose.
You're not
giving She'll bring in Yoda, but except also another female character that's, like, more powerful than Yoda.
Well, isn't that the rumor that the final episode's supposed to have Yoda? Episode 7? Well,
so something the Fringy highlighted that I thought was really interesting is he's noticed that Carrion Moss keeps getting the with credit, but we haven't gotten an and credit yet, and he thinks that's going to go to Frank Oz.
Right.
Hmm.
And if that could fit, and that means we could get Yoda in the last episode, last scene, where Yoda says, "Cover all of this up, we will." And everyone will be mad.
Yeah.
Dude.
Oh, God.
This, I did like as well, speaking of Carrion Moss, I like when characters specifically say they can't get into an area because it's inaccessible. And then when the script needs them to appear, they just teleport in.
Indara leaps in, puts the Wookiee down, and hovers her open hand over his temple. Sol catches his breath.
He does.
Dude, I'm not gonna lie. I think this might be my favorite part of the whole episode, where Trinity kills all the witches. I thought it was just.
I'm gonna skip forward to it. I just the way they all collapse is just incredible.
Kelnaka blinks, his eyes return to normal.
Get the twins. Oh, wait.
Into a lifeless heap.
You got the...
Yeah, there we go.
Purses her lips and turns her head to one side. In the common room, the witches all collapse into a lifeless heap.
What if this is a callback to The Matrix, how when you disconnect abruptly, you die?
Probably.
That's
the body cannot live out the mind.
So this was kind of blew up in the first 1 minute of this stream. So much for the power of many.
Literally. Literally. Like, well, maybe she also killed them.
Well, it seems like it, but I don't think that's unfair.
That's OP as shit. She just like turns her head, kind of like cracking all their heads, and they all just croak.
Oh, it's OP.
No, I think what they just give is, up. It's like they've got all the life force drained out of them. I'm going
to
see this
from
again.
A character choice perspective, forcing a friend to kill all of us, so I'll kill all of you. You know what I mean? It's just like, sorry, witches. Yeah. Maybe you shouldn't have done what you did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's the way they all go down. It's like,
why do you?
It's just also just, it's so comical how they all tip over. It's so, like, so bad.
You couldn't have them go up in flames or like a boulder fall on them or, you know, whatever.
Why
this one in the middle she got her moment, like,
yeah, hung around
for episode three. The why didn't they have them just make Kelnaka lightsaber himself and then take over the next Jedi lightsaber himself? Next Jedi lightsaber, wouldn't that be the fastest way to actually kill them all?
Yeah,
I don't know, dude.
God, the choreography was painful.
Didn't find out
that they nerfed the shit out of Kelnaka's strength. It was actually sad.
Well, it's when like little bitch boy is like holding him at bay with his lightsaber kind of turned.
Yeah, no way.
Like this, like, you know, like the most awkward way to try and block a blow, and suddenly that's like fending off a Wookiee. Yeah, I don't even know how to describe it. It's like tries to bent at the most awkward angle imaginable. You can
no leverage at all.
Sol tries to melee fight a Wookiee. There is a moment where they're having a fucking physical fight. I was like, are you kidding me? Do they not know what a Wookiee is? Sol is dead. He grabbed Sol by the neck. He's dead. It's a Wookiee.
He could crush you like fucking Homelander. Like, yeah, it's just
pretty much.
Yeah.
How did the Wookiee die, by the way?
He got killed by Smiler Ren off screen.
But he's just like kind of slumped over. Like, how did he kill him?
But well, it was sizzling in his chest.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's his story done.
There you go.
Yeah. I think the whole idea of having a Wookiee as a Jedi is like, I assume this has been done in the EU, but it just is kind of laughable when you see it on screen. You know, and they're trying to be like these paragons of wisdom and self-control, and it's like, all you get out of them every time is,
That's why I was interested in it. It's a creature that is inherently very, like, hard to control its rage. It's known for its irritability sort of thing, but it's a Jedi. It's like, that's, what can you do with that? They did nothing. Nothing at all.
We gave him a scanner.
And it just looks so cheap. His suit looks so cheap. Even Torben's wig looks so terrible.
Oh, all of it. The green screen with the speeder. I mean, it looked better in Return of the Jedi back in 83. Yeah. What is this? $180 million What is this, dude?
Yeah, when Saul comes to a stop with it, like, it's so clunky. Like, it just, it goes along and then just
stop.
Yeah.
Freeze frame. Darn. Yeah. Like, it doesn't look natural. Well,
it's just
like,
a director who doesn't know what she's doing or hiring the wrong people. So,
yeah.
We're all sighing.
I mean, if you had to rank this amongst the other episodes of this season, like, how low does it go for you? Is this the worst or is it?
I've already said this is. For me, this is worse than The Last Jedi.
Right.
It's just, it literally makes me angry watching. At least with The Last Jedi, I'm like, this is shit. Like, you just ruined.
Oh, I was made furious by characters. That.
But this, I'm like, what are you doing? Like, this is just ridiculous.
At least with this show, like, it doesn't have established characters that it's messing with.
Yet.
You know, like, I think that was what made that's what made TLJ so much harder to stomach, whereas, like, you've got Luke Skywalker, like, the crown jewel of Star Wars, and you just took a big old dump on his face.
It kind of does in different ways, because it's now asserting dominance over very important points in the prequel trilogy.
You're not wrong. I find it's closer to my heart if you go after Luke Skywalker than if you go after, you know, established rules related to the visions and the Force or the creation of Force.
Yeah.
But, like, I still get you in terms of you don't want people fucking with that.
No, that's like the most important. You had a peace for 1,000 years, and then you have the prophecy kind of becoming true for how long? Thousands of years? And says, I've found a virgin. I've literally found the prophecy. It's like, holy shit, what? Mm. Oh, no, but 87 years ago, we had two of them. Okay, yeah. Well, you know, found another one.
We don't talk about it.
I can only liken this to, this is exactly like what they did with Star Trek, where you thought that, like, you know, Kirk and McCoy and Spock were, like, the originators of this franchise, and like when they went out into the galaxy to explore, this was they were blazing a trail and so on. And then you got something like Star Trek Discovery, where you actually find out like Michael Burnham is the real originator of all of this, and she actually taught Spock to be the awesome science officer that he is because he was like retarded or something before he met her. That's the same level of just retcon and stuff, and it's reaching your claws back into the past and into the future so you can say, like, we now encompass the whole franchise. Like, our control is over everything. And it's very obvious when you see what they're doing and you understand the rationale behind it. My God, it's pretty
good. Yeah.
That's a right thing.
Do you think we're going to get a season 2?
Better not.
I hope so.
Better not.
Probably. I think probably.
We're at the point where we actually can't even tell. As in, like, there's nothing to go on. If it made $0 or cost them nothing but horrible, horrible results, they might still make a season 2.
That'd be one of the dumbest decisions.
They will. Well, they're just writing off money at this point. I really failed to believe this whole thing cost $180 million.
No, how did Revenge of the Sith? Me that cost that.
Bro, how did Revenge of the Sith cost $114? And this cost $180?
Yeah.
What?
I mean, did you see that makeup on witch number 47? with the old ladies.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah,
that costs a lot of money. That's those speeder bikes, you know.
Well, even the witch lady, even
they were doing old... back in 83, they did that stuff, you know.
Even the powerful ancient witch who looked like she was 10,000 years old couldn't survive the tethering of the Wi-Fi.
Yeah. I did like this one as well. Moses Lack says, Drinker, I thought witch number 13 did a pretty good job. Oh, well, back to huffing paint thinner. That's the ideal way to get through this show.
Yeah. Yeah.
To me, the main damage that the show is doing to Star Wars really is just turning morality upside down, because it was very clearly about light versus darkness. And now there's this trying to, like, you know, sexify the dark side. Mm-hmm. Every single actor is obsessed with the dark side. They want to be there and they want to make the Jedi look like, you know, power hungry and this institution, right? That was one of the lines from the last episode, is that she shouldn't be raised by an institution. She should be raised by a family.
Oh my God. When they're a cult.
When they're actually a cult. And that, I think that's the real damage, that you can see that how much our culture has gotten corrupted because of the concept of moral ambiguity. Is that, you know, it's like we kind of laugh at that line that Anakin says. It's like, the Jedi are bad from my side. And that was such a terrible line, but we had no idea how much worse things could get. And this is really about, like, oh, the Sith have their reason. Why are they the Sith after this? They want freedom from a corrupt institution. And I think the whole concept of institutional corruption is actually it could be very interesting. You could have sort of a nuanced approach to it and say that when an institution that started off with ideals and it ends up being infiltrated by people who don't no longer believe in those ideals, they pretend to believe in those ideals, but they're actually using it to exert control over people. That happens all the time. And you could make it this interesting concept of infighting, of like idealists versus corrupted people trying to take them out of the institution. Anything could be, but they have a very, weirdly, in their argument for moral ambiguity, they take a very black and white approach on we're right because we're a cult of women who are interested in only being with women, and they're wrong because they're a cult of, you know, who don't approve of that.
I think moral ambiguity can be super interesting when handled by people who have an understanding of the difference between good and bad, not by people who have either flipped them or have no clue, to the point where they're like, hey, I don't know, you should be able to just mind control and torture your guests when they enter your building. I don't know, that makes you evil now, okay.
I couldn't help but notice the parallels with Leslie Headland's own career, like where it's like someone in a position of power taking advantage of someone much younger and more vulnerable, and like they're crying for help, and like everyone else around them is just not seeing what's going on.
There's so many aspects to how horrible
you're going, Leslie.
But when that happened, and they showed there was a shot of Torbin sitting down and Trinity looking at him, and I was like, I don't know if they've had a conversation or not, but obviously, how would it go? What happened to you, Torbin? It's like, well. Everyone disappeared. The whole place went dark. And then she started talking to me about how she can indulge in my core desires. I can just do whatever I want. There's no discipline. There's no sense of anything if I simply kneel to her. And then Trinity would say, she's a dark side user. Like, she's trying to corrupt you. I need to report this to the council. And then she does. And the council say, can you be sure? And she's like, yeah, I can detect from Torbin. He's telling me the truth. This is a dark side cult, and they're attempting to get people in by mind control. What should we do? And then they should say, we're going to send you Jedi Masters, because this is clearly an event that's clearly important. As opposed to,
Well, not just that, but like perhaps like provide a little bit of reassurance to him as a human being. Like, you know, I'm sorry you had to undergo this traumatic experience. Like, we're here for you. Because I fucking guarantee you, if the genders were reversed on this one, like, that would be portrayed as a horrific, traumatic violation of a person's soul. But, because it's like...
For a woman to be told to kneel? If on a show a woman is being told kneel, that would be, I mean, everybody would lose their minds. Yeah.
Could you imagine some dude infiltrating a girl's mind and then being like, I will never deny you. I'll give you whatever you want. Now get on your knees.
Get on your knees. Yeah,
what?
They have no idea what they're doing.
Oh, but it's okay the other way. Right.
I think perhaps they wanted the aesthetic of a white guy kneeling before a black woman. I'm just saying.
Well, yes, I think
that's
queen.
What they were after.
Like, not only should Torben never go back there after that event, but I find it hilarious that Sol is like, hey, this time, don't let them in your mind. Totally yeah. Like, oh, okay.
Like, all right.
I totally let them in the first time, bro.
And then freaking Padawan fortifies his mind, but a Jedi Master Wookiee can't.
Like, I was thinking of like Multiverse of Madness as well. Like, fortify your minds.
Yeah,
yeah, literally.
We've had this line before.
It's bullshit.
It's
just written by someone who doesn't understand any of the rules in Star Wars whatsoever. And it's like, this is not even good outside of Star Wars. This is just shit.
Yeah. I think that's a pretty good summary of it, really.
We should talk about the part where Sol thinks I can hold up the bridge, but I can't hold up the people. Dumbass.
Grab the people.
I still haven't had any of the supporters of this show that blindly defend this, come up with a plausible explanation as to why he did that. All they do is deflect and go, why didn't Obi-Wan use force speed?
Which, by the way, there are better explanations for that than there are for this, because I've seen people say... Sol was exhausted. It's like, so exhausted he could hold up the bridge but not the people. That doesn't work.
Literally.
Try again.
Literally.
And they're like, shut up. Why do you care?
All right. Stop questioning it.
Yeah, literally.
But even when there's
the thing, a question I have about Torben as well, right? I keep coming back to him because it's mentioned that he hasn't spoken to anyone for 10 years, right? So, like, it's been 16 years since the events of this planet. So, for 6 years, was he pretty chill? And he was, like, just going about his business, becoming a master and stuff. And then, after 6 years, decided, I'm really racked with guilt about this.
Yeah.
And he'd go into a fucking force bubble and just meditate for 10 years.
They did him so dirty with the hair, the balding hair. They did him so dirty with that.
He was in the force bubble from the get-go, right, for 10 years. 5 years in, the Jedi Masters go, that's pretty impressive. But the other one goes, Jedi Master impressive? He's like, should we just Jedi Master? Yeah, okay. Yeah, he's a Jedi Master. Good job, buddy.
You're the strong and silent type. We like that.
No. He's a Jedi Master on that planet, in that little shit Jedi temple where, like, Mei could just drop in from the ceiling and, like, infiltrate the whole base.
Yeah, who's going to stop him? Like Jedi Chunker, that's like fucking 30 stone.
Chunker, that's the level for Padawan. Level for Jedi Master is probably pretty low.
Who gets distracted by women instead of doing his job? Like, my God.
We had a suggestion on Last Orders actually, where Mei does that force push and it's like a big whirlwind of like smoke and stuff, and they all get knocked back. Oh no, sorry. Smile Ren does it. If he was there, and it's like because of his sheer mass, he just doesn't move at all, and everyone else gets thrown back. I think that could be something.
He's like, it just pans in. I am the Jedi Master. Does wushu.
I love the Jedi because
pushes the Jungus, and he does like a full roll 360 back, and it's standing on his legs still. You know, like he goes, whoa. Hey. The
Kung Fu Panda. Yeah.
There was another question here that came up from B Rizzle Channel. It says, big fan and big watcher of you guys. Question for all of you. I want to start producing, and I personally want to bring back George Lucas's Star Wars. Do you think the Star Wars is even recoverable, and do you think it's worth the time and effort to try and pursue this endeavor?
You can always decanonize.
Yeah.
We talked about it again and again. It's the first thing we would do. We'd be like, hey, everybody, good news. Everything from Disney's gone.
Yep.
That's when you literally own the company, which is like Elon Musk levels, sadly.
All right. Well, a few more super chats.
I wouldn't be surprised if he owned it and then ended up calling up a bunch of YouTubers to come in, like us.
Why not?
Crazy.
He seems like that kind of dude where he's like, yeah, sure.
I don't think Disney would ever sell it, though. I feel like they'd grip it with a sense of, you can't take this from us.
I think if someone came with like $50 billion, they would sell it.
I mean, sure, they'd have to. Like, it's worth what, like 10% of that, if that.
Do you think we could raise $50 billion?
If you,
me, Mahler, Tyrone, Nerdrotic, freak, I don't know, like a whole bunch of like Moist Critical, like a whole bunch of guys just get together.
I don't think we can
and try to raise
I've
money.
Got an idea. I'm going to start an OnlyFans, right? And you have to pay me not to take my clothes off. So I reckon $50 billion.
The threat is always looming, but the glasses stay on.
Yeah, that's the only thing that stays on.
You're about to take it off all the time and pay you now.
We just need 5 billion people to give us $10, and we should be good.
Yeah, like there you go. It's like 8 billion on the planet. So what are you guys doing?
I bet you Mr. Beast could do it.
Yeah.
I don't think it would take much for him.
I mean, he's already contemplating running for president, so we just don't know what's going to happen in the future.
If they can lower the age limit on that,
what's the age limit? In the States?
It's like 35.
35.
Yeah.
Is he not 35 yet?
He's 23. He's very young.
No.
I mean, I could probably argue you should have like an upward age limit as well, but
He is not 23, is he?
Yeah, he's ridiculously young.
No way. Oh, he's 26.
26.
Sorry. Oh, he's an old man then.
He's still pretty young.
Okay, but 23, 26 at least, he's like the
26, and he's like the most successful YouTuber on the platform
in the world. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which Speed is 19 years old. Holy shit.
Yeah. I tell you what, though, right? Because we've been ragging on the Acolyte, but you know, we've been doing it wrong, according to Kotaku. And I felt like this article was worth talking about a little bit, because it's from everyone's purveyor of fantastic gold takes, Alyssa Mercante, you know, who's become the darling of Twitter recently. Says, if you're mad about the Acolyte, then you haven't been paying attention to Star Wars. The latest episode of Star Wars Disney Plus series shows the dangers of the Jedi's hubris. So it says here, the Acolyte has been open about its intentions from the jump to portray the Jedi Order at the height of its power and show how they are responsible for their own fall from grace, the same fall that we watched play out in the prequels 20 years ago. But despite the Acolyte's consistency in depicting that vision, the fetid Sarlacc pit that is corners of the Star Wars fandom continues to insist that the series is breaking canon, destroying lore, and otherwise ruining a piece of media that they've made their entire personality. I mean, where's the lie there? It's done all of those things, I think. The latest episode only fueled those fires, even though it echoes sentiments and sorrows first seen in The Phantom Menace. I mean, do we agree with that one, I guess? It's a take, that's for sure. It goes on. The Jedi didn't seem wholly innocent. Plus, Mei survives and is on a mission to kill all four of them who were there that day. And Osha eventually leaves the Order for reasons unknown. That's still not been answered, by the way, why she left. And we've only got one episode left.
Well, she said she failed in episode 6. That's all we got.
Well, that's good enough for me. But now we know exactly what happened on that fateful night, and it paints a stark picture of the Jedi's fallibility, the dangers of assumption, and the flaws of tying a religious group to a governing body. And this is where it gets amazing. So Saul, who first spotted Mei and Osha in the forest, followed them to the Coven's safe haven, or their safe space, if you will. Believes the witches are a dangerous, dark-aligned group who could be sacrificing children, which is a belief which is entirely justified, I think. And be fair, his perspective is damning. Their behavior could certainly look strange when, since childhood, you've been part of a group that believes only its version of praying and practicing religion is valid. Naturally, you'd be freaked out by 50 or so women chanting in front of a giant scary hole in the ground. I think there's a bit more to it than that, to be fair.
And what if that coven was the one who was in charge of a governing body? What if it wasn't in power? That would be acceptable, right?
His misunderstanding of what is clearly a much more complicated situation than witches bad leads him to believe that he must save the girls, especially Osha, who he thinks is meant to be his Padawan. Though Carrie-Anne Moss tells him not to meddle in these affairs, the girls take the Jedi test and warns him of the dangers of getting involved. Saul refuses to listen, essentially egging his frustrated Padawan, Torben, who hops on a speeder to rescue the two girls so that he can go back to Coruscant. Things go downhill fast with their arrival kicking off a massive fight during which Osha and Mei's mother, Anasea is killed by Saul as she begins using magic in a way that clearly scares him. It would fucking scare anyone. It's terrifying. She turned into a demon smoke monster with like big scary teeth and everything.
And started killing a child. Like, it was whatever, nice, doing whatever to it.
It was a nice scary demon monster, actually.
You see the the framing of this. It's like, it's not like she was doing something that was clearly like horrific and could, you know, any sane person would interpret it as a threatening move. It's he was scared. He was just a scared little man who couldn't handle the powerful woman that was in front of him. It's like you're trying to reframe something that is clearly painting her in the wrong to try and portray Saul as being the aggressor here. And it's so disingenuous. It's exactly what I expect from Kotaku, to be fair. It says that the witches then possess Kilnaka, who beats Saul and Torben, only for the coven to be knocked unconscious by Indara, who force shoves them out of Kilnaka's head. I mean, they're not knocked unconscious, they're just dead. Their brains explode or something.
Fucking dead. Yeah.
They're disconnected from the force matrix.
Literally. Well, even the fighting was supposed to be matrix inspired, you could tell. And it's like,
right.
All right, dude. Like, we get your fangirling over Moss being in this, but come on. Like, this is Star Wars.
But again, the article is trying to, it's trying to frame the entire situation in a way that makes the Jedi into the bad guys. And it's exactly what the episode did. But both of them are so incompetent at what they're doing that, like, it just makes the Jedi seem even more justified in what they did. It's like, oh, well, okay, sure, Anasea turned into a smoke demon and, like, tried to vaporize a girl, but, you know, Saul overreacted and panicked because he was scared of her and, like, you know, it was really his fault. And, yeah, the rest of the coven possessed one of the Jedi and tried to make him kill the others, but, you know, what else can you do in that situation?
Like, but it's written to appease to the liberal arts types that see morality just from, like, which you know, protected group is involved in something. So it's like, oh, they're women, you know, they're women of color. So of course, anything they do is morally okay. So like the right type of audience for their work, which luckily is very small, but they're also very vocal online. They look at it as like, yeah, you know, the Jedi, clearly they overstepped their boundaries. Who are they to come in here and look at this? They just executed on a mass genocide of indigenous people on this planet, and they're applauding this representation of those types of stories are being told on screen now.
I'm honestly surprised that the real revelation wasn't that the Jedi just massacred all of the witches with lightsabers, because Carrie-Anne Moss in this, like, she had no way of knowing that her saving Kilnaka from this mind control was going to kill all of the witches.
Nope.
So, like, again, like, this isn't her, like, this isn't any of their faults. They didn't do anything wrong. Right. It would be different if, like, it was a tense standoff and someone jumped the gun and, like, the Jedi just went into kill mode and they massacred all of the witches. Like, okay, that's pretty horrific. That's damning. This is just like, nope, people making the best decisions they can with the information they have at their disposal.
Yes.
Ryan had suggested, I'm sure he would agree, the simplest things, like Torben, how do we characterize him? Make it so that his interest in the Jedi was he wanted to become like a heroic, awesome savior of people. He gets that interaction at first at the temple, whatever the fuck it is, and obviously he's kind of now afraid, but also challenged and wants to take him on a bit and get some, like, you know, he feels like he was fucked up and he's like, no, I can beat them, I can get over it. And then it's like they you know, get some reason to think they are attacking those children, and then you charge in. It's like pretty easy as a sort of, you know, and he can be the brash one. Saul can be the one that's like, he's aggressive, but he's right. And then Kilnaka can back up Saul or whatever, for every reason. And that you've got Indara trying to control the situation, but recognizes something's wrong here.
Yeah.
And it could be built on misunderstandings and then rushed forward by characteristics that are built, like, how you could have spent time establishing Torben as a character. He could have been this kid who's wide-eyed and interested in the Jedi, sees them as heroes, wants to be a hero himself, and goes too far. It's as simple as that.
And then the fact that they switch places, the two girls, they switch places, and they're each getting told the reality of how things really played out could have been also opposite takes, right? Like the Jedis are sharing about how this cult really had her indoctrinated. And then Kylo Ren, Smilo Ren, could have told her, like, no, actually the Jedi are capable of making mistakes. And here's my experience of what happened to me when I was training as a Jedi. Like, it could have been, that could have been an interesting take too.
Right. The frustrating thing is that there's elements of this whole series. Like, if you were to describe it at a high level, like, you know, two sisters who were like, who have a shared trauma relating to the Jedi, and that's put them down opposite paths, but they're both very powerful, and they have to like try and like reconcile their destiny within the Force from very different philosophical perspectives. That's going to cast some doubts over like how justified the Jedi are as a force of peace within the galaxy. There's a lot you can do there in the hands of good writers. Like the fundamental premise isn't terrible. Mm-hmm. It's just it's implemented by fucking idiots. And like, this is what you end up with. They take the worst possible route to any kind of resolution throughout this entire show. Yeah. It's frustrating to see because there is something interesting there. It's just, these are the wrong people to be implementing it.
And even the concept that they are two parts of a whole, right? That could have been really interesting too, is that they each embody the sort of duality of a single person. Is that one side can be very optimistic, and that could be one character, is that she's going through life with unbelievable optimism and just trusting whoever she meets. And then there's the other side, which is like the rage, that there's nothing but anger, and how both of them are suffering in their own way because they actually need to unite to see the world in its true reality. That could have been interesting too, but yeah, any complexity they shrivel up from pretty quickly.
It's not the ideas, it's the execution. But what if they actually did mean for Trinity to know what she was doing? Cut that. Because they're already trying to make the Jedi look bad, right? So, there you go.
The thing is, though, if I were, like, on the High Council and she reports, I killed all the witches in an attempt to save Kel Narka from being mind-controlled into killing us, I'd be like, huh. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's acceptable.
If someone said, like, no, she should be fired, I'd be like, why?
That's a pretty big power, though.
Well, yeah, but I'm not talking about the power side of it. I don't think it matches that she's able to do that. I don't think it matches from Star Wars, nor does it match from Leslie Headland's own logic of the power of one too many. I don't know. Like, what the hell was that?
Trinity
outclassed the entire coven. What the hell?
Yeah, it doesn't make sense that happened.
But putting that to aside, just looking at the actions from a character point of view, I don't see why that would give Trinity guilt. And I love the idea, by the way. Fucking first episode being like, you guys kill the unarmed. Are you actually referencing the fact that she killed all the witches who used their power to attempt to kill them with Kel Narka? That doesn't count as a weapon.
They were just defending themselves. But they were just defending themselves.
At this point, it's the most arbitrary fucking distinction in the history of weaponry. Like, it doesn't count. If I push a boulder off a cliff, it's like, I don't have a weapon. What do you mean? Yeah. I didn't do nothing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, they're gravity. Powerless That's women, the... Mauler. Okay? Powerless. Oh, yeah.
And that's the thing. It's like, I think if you rewatch the show, it's going to be distinctly, it was already terrible, but even worse, because you know now the story that May is trying to get revenge for, and you sit there like, what the hell? It's so stupid. And May was the reason that most of them would have died anyway. She set the whole place on fire.
Yeah,
I refuse to watch it over again. That's not going to happen.
Hell no, man. Like, I don't even want to, like, I'm so glad it's over. I'm so happy that it's almost done next week.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. The only part I'm forwarding, just like the parts where they're just walking, because there are such long walking shots.
Question for all three of you: what's going to happen in the next episode? What do you think? How's the show going to end?
Well, it's just going to be all Smilo Ren and Osha and May are probably going to like team up or some bullshit, and there's going to be some bigger Sith that comes in, probably Tenebris or Venomous or I don't know, dude. They're gonna make someone, and
why can't they have a Sith called Derek?
Alan.
Jonathan.
There needs to be an Alan. Derek.
Timothy.
Double.
Toby. Toby.
Nigel.
I'm here to destroy you all. Oh, it's just Toby. Don't worry about it.
Part of my assumption with this is just that they'll be flipping. Osho will hate the Jedi much more now than ever, and Mei will be like, maybe the Jedi aren't so bad.
Oh,
I'm still having a hard time getting over that foot stomp from the episode 6? Foot stomp and then the eye splooge with the oil.
Can you truly expect anyone to remember episode 6, really?
No.
What was the foot stomp?
With the otter? The gopher or whatever?
Yeah. With the
Basil.
Yeah. Basil. Yeah, there you go. And then she gets the oil splooge.
Oh, that was so a weird. Three Stooges moment right there. Yeah. That was
1990s Disney.
And the thing is, that's the sort of thing that should happen to the protagonist if you just want like a little funny moment, but not the antagonist of the story.
The villain.
Yeah. Who's about to confront Jedi. The man who's responsible for destroying her life. Yeah. Like, really? Like, this is where you're going with this?
Yeah. Who she doesn't stab in the back just because he tells her, like, hey, can you take over here? She's like, okay, well, if I have work, I'm not going
to stab you. I was about to settle, like, a 16-year grudge and murder you, but, you know.
Think about that.
I am a woman, so I am going to do as I'm told.
No,
he's like, make me a sandwich. Okay.
Oh god.
I've been training for this many years to kill you, but you know what? I guess I can wait.
Yeah.
Just a little longer.
Up a ribbon for you, it's fine.
You expect getting something like the Naked Gun or something. Somebody getting ready to kill someone.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure, I got it.
And then turn around.
Just before we go on, I just wanted to ask this. This is from Radio Spec, who super chatted us. Says, thank you, Drinker and Mauler. Your channels and those of various members of the panel have helped me to rediscover my love for good media. I want to start my own YouTube channel to articulate my ideas about my own favorite media. What advice would you offer? This is for the whole panel. So any advice that we could offer someone to grow their channel, like how can they get a good start? And do well, because we've got some pretty successful people here on the panel, so I'll turn it over to you guys.
Well, I'll go. The thing I tell everyone is just when you start and don't stop. That consistency is huge, and upload at least once a week, because when you stop, you lose that momentum, and it's like... From what I've noticed, people blow up anywhere from 3 to 5 years in. That's kind of like the average, from what I understand. 3 to 5 years, remember that. You could blow up tomorrow. It could be a little bit after 5, but if you truly want to do this, you have to keep going and you can't stop. I've had several friends stop that were right there. They really were doing stuff and they just gave up. So that's my little tidbit.
That's great.
Just make content you like. Just make content you enjoy. I feel like once you start trying to feed the machine and you want to get viral and this and that, and you're like, oh shit, this video didn't do well. It just demotivates you. And, you know, just make shit you like. And if it sticks, it sticks. If it doesn't, it doesn't. At least a few people enjoy it.
Find full motivation and fulfillment from the numbers as opposed to the content itself and your expression in that content. You're going to want to find yourself finding meaning in the stuff you're making. Otherwise, you're going to, like, so many people have crumbled away because they've lost all motivation. So many YouTubers I've known over the years who've said, like, I've completely lost my interest in doing this. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the time it can be that it starts out with passion, slowly converts over to the numbers and the algorithm, and then eventually becomes this horrible albatross that they're dragging along with their life and they don't want it anymore. So stick to the passion.
Can I present a counterpoint to this suggestion? And I don't want to be Mr. like contrarian here, but in the early stages of your channel, when you want to grow it and you want to get noticed, because this is the hardest thing in YouTube is just to get that initial bump, like just get over that hump and like get some traction.
Yep,
that is the hardest thing. And I might suggest that it's worth talking about things which are currently in the news at the time. So if you're choosing to review movies, for example, or TV shows, that sort of thing. The Acolyte right now would be a good place to start, because a lot of people will be searching for content like that. And so there's a built-in audience for it. You know, you can for sure start talking about, like, obscure low budget horror movies from the 1970s made entirely in Sweden or whatever, right, if you want, if that's your passion. But not many people are going to be looking for that sort of thing, and so there's a balance there I think you might want to strike. And if you just want to get that initial movement on your channel and get some audience, I think it's probably a good idea to find the thing that's really popular at the time or that a lot of people are very invested in learning more about, because that's where your audience is going to be.
Not to actually literally do this, but you want that Venn diagram of stuff you care about and stuff everyone cares about, and then go for the one that's in the middle.
The thing is, it becomes a luxury that you're afforded when you're more successful. So, like, you know, probably all of us, we've got pretty big channels, and so every so often we can just talk about a certain thing that we are personally really invested in, and it might not get a huge amount of views, but it's okay because, you know, our audience will stick around.
Yeah,
they'll be there for the next video.
Yeah, it may not be as popular as, you know, like something that's trending, but it still gets a core audience. The hardcore guys will come in and check it out.
Something I try to do, and I think all of us, you know, take the opportunities where we can. When you got something topical, you can then be like, hey, this done right is actually this. And then you talk about that Swedish horror movie from the 1970s, and people are like, huh? And you're like, hey, but it's the same story, but done right, you know?
Case in point, when PewDiePie was reviewing books, like books no one has really heard of all that much, and like it was getting millions of views. If some regular person reviewed that book, man, they no views.
Yeah. Well, books are a nightmare to review because, one, you have no visuals that you can present to people, so it's very difficult to make a video about it anyway. And two, unless it's like the next Harry Potter or something, like people aren't going to be looking for it necessarily anyway, so it's a tricky one to make work.
It gets to the point where people are more invested in what you have to say compared to the actual content itself of what you're talking about.
Case in point, the Acolyte.
And I would just say that when you're trying to figure out what you could be doing better or what works out in the market, don't just look at successes, look at failures as well. So it's very easy to just see examples of people doing content really well. But you might draw lessons from that don't necessarily attach to success. There's that concept of success bias, is that you'll see that, oh, this person, all these people are doing this, but that might just be an accident that then they still happen to be successful. So look at what also makes people fail, and then draw your conclusions. Try to look at equal examples of both.
Yeah, I think that's fair. Like, damn, this guy really got his money's worth out of that question.
That should be enough.
And it just helps. It helps me to listen to that too, because I feel like, you know, we've all been doing this for a really long time. I've been doing this for 4 years, and it's easy to lose sight of what you started with and where you're at. I think the other side that's also new to me is that what happens when some of your videos go viral and they do well, and then later on you're like, okay, well, I don't want to talk about that anymore. I want to move on from that. I want to talk about other things, but those videos are not doing as well. But you're in your mind, you're like, well, does that mean I'm failing? Does that mean I'm failing because my views are not as high as they used to be? But that there's I think so much of success is not just the steady rise. It's a lot of it is up and down. A lot of it is step functions. A lot of it is like running in place sometimes. So I think just even hearing you guys talk about how you guys think about it, it's heartening to remember what the overarching goal is.
Yeah. And I think it's, you know, you always want to imagine that you're going to capitalize on that wave. Like when you have a video go viral and it's like, oh, okay, like I'll just make other videos like this and every one of them is going to do like 2 million views or whatever. And like, it doesn't always work like that. You hope, like the best scenario though is that you retain some of that core audience and then they subscribe to you, and then that gradually builds up your channel and away you go. And it is a period of figuring out what works. Like, excuse me, when my channel took off, like it was because of a video where I was being like super sarcastic and like showing the exact opposite of what I was saying, and I thought like, okay, should every video be like this? And then I thought, no, that's going to be really difficult to do after a while, and it's going to be really restrictive. So you experiment a little bit and it's like, okay, well, these aspects of it work fine, and I can you know, tailor other parts of it that work better and allow me to do the things I need to do to be able to review stuff or talk about the things I care about. And so it's finding that marriage between, I guess, what your audience wants and what you want to do. So not always easy, but hopefully eventually you find a sweet spot in the middle.
I would say with, like, you guys kind of have the luxury of talking about whatever you want. I'm just kind of stuck to Star Wars, at least on this channel. So I find, you know, like, it's weird with my channel because when Star Wars is dead, it'll perform as if I have maybe 250 to 500,000 subs, if that. But when Star Wars is popping, it'll perform sometimes, like when The Mandalorian was out, dude, it performed like I had 10 million subs.
Yeah.
It's weird, and I've just kind of accepted it. Where it's kind of held to the popularity of Star Wars at the moment. But that being said, back in 2017, 2016, 17, 18, dude, anything that I would put out, like fan fictions, comics, lore videos, those would just pop off like crazy, like just hundreds of thousands of views within the first day. And today, it's just not the case. People just do not care nearly as much as they used to.
Because it did.
Yeah. I suppose like it's easy to go to that other side of the coin and just be super critical of everything Star Wars related, you know, which certainly I have been, but you know, I don't suppose you want to have to do that anyway, because then you're pigeonholed into another like restrictive category where it's like, well, I can't just be the guy who hates on Star Wars now, because like, what's that accomplishing?
Well, right. You know what I've actually realized is this is the very first time that I've actually been extremely critical of Star Wars, because this is shit. Like, there's nothing I could even theorize or come up with. I don't want to. That's how bad it is. And I've noticed that like, it is, the views are literally pretty much the same as if it was popping, if it was good. It's so strange because people are just like, they're still emotional, but they're pissed off.
Yeah.
So they want to see like, okay, well, what does someone who like understands Star Wars think about this, or vice versa, what, you know, whatever. So it's that's been kind of a learning experience for me. It's after 8 years, it's
the fans are still united, whether it's good or bad. They're united.
Yeah. You just, if you, it's crazy. It's wild.
Yeah. I mean, at the very least, like, at least you're being honest. And so like, I think people would have a problem if you were trying to pretend like the Acolyte is actually good and like trying to sell it on people because you just you didn't want to be too critical of Star Wars.
Yeah.
Then people would be disengaged from it because they would know you're not telling the truth.
Well, you're a fake shill. You're exactly
right. So
you're stuck.
Stay honest.
Yeah.
Theory, by the way, that I first got exposed to your content because of your reaction to The Mandalorian season end when Luke Skywalker comes up.
Right.
And of course, at that time, that journalist made some pretty disparaging remarks about you. And to me, when I saw your video, it made me cry because to me, I had not, when I watched Luke's entrance, it didn't hit me that hard because he's not my main hero. I just didn't grow up with him.
Right.
But seeing how much you cared about him helped me actually contextualize why Luke was so important to so many people. And that's when it actually helped me feel the hurt that many people feel at having such a terrible destruction of a hero that's been loved for so many decades. So I really appreciated that you shared the candor of that, because it's easy to miss that, you know. It's easy to you could just say Luke Skywalker is a hero I care about, you know. Whereas that moment was so powerful that you showed how you truly felt about that. That was really great.
Oh, it just kind of happened. I didn't. I tried to hold it back, but it didn't work too well.
It made sense to me, man.
Years after that, I can kind of analyze if The Last Jedi had not gone the way it did, I don't think I would have been as emotional at all. I would have been like, yeah, this is cool, awesome. But the fact that it, you know, Ryan did what he did with Luke and then he comes back in this heroic way, it's like that was probably what my reaction would have been like in The Last Jedi had it been something that we were hoping it to be.
Yeah. That was real fan emotion, man. When I went to find it, when I saw it, I expected it. Like, I didn't expect it, but then when I saw you crying, I was like, of course. He's a huge fan, and they finally gave the biggest hero of the series justice.
Mm-hmm. I thought he was dead. So, you know,
I think sometimes, like, seeing these reaction videos to things, it almost heightens your emotion because when you see what it means to other people, I guess like there's that empathetic side of you that just kind of feels that.
Yeah.
You know, it's like almost through osmosis, like you feel their reaction as well.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, did you have any qualms about like showing that kind of reaction online? Mm-hmm. Like just knowing, I guess, how many people would see it, and like some people are going to be like super, you know, invested in it, and other people might be like, oh, I can't believe you're crying over this or whatever. Like, did you have any hesitation about it? Or,
oh, dude, I was trying to. That's why the cry looked so weird when I watch it back. I'm like, that's not how I normally cry. I'm like trying to hold that shit in hard. and like my lips are trembling, and I just couldn't. And I just did not even look at the live stream. And I think it was like maybe like, I don't know, 14,000 or something before. And then once I stopped crying and I kind of like looked at it, I'm like, oh shit, 35,000 people. Nice. I was crying in front of that many people. I'm like, cool. But the overall consensus was everyone was so happy about it, and a lot of them were emotional about it too, so that was nice. But yeah, I tried to hide it. I really tried.
Authenticity, man, it sells. Yeah. Someone's real, people really believe you're real. Not, that's why the shilling doesn't work, man.
Yeah,
because they're going to eventually trip over that, you know what I mean, in the future.
Tyrone, yeah. there's so many of these like level one elite shills that I know personally, and they just behind the scenes they think totally different. It's crazy. Really?
I've gotten some emails from people that are like, we're glad you're saying what you're saying.
It's crazy.
But it's like we can't. So thank you.
Isn't even like even Grace Randolph now has turned against I've seen that. Like if she still thinks it's bad, like know. Good lord.
I don't really know who she is. She's a journalist, right?
I think so.
I'm writer or something at first, right?
I'm convinced she's like a rogue AI that's kind of retarded. Because there's something like uncanny about her. Like this isn't how human beings talk and behave and look. But I don't know.
For the record, by the way, because didn't want to interrupt the moment being had, but I fucking despise that Luke scene, and I had the exact.
Oh, nice one! Wait, kill the emotion.
Hey, I let it happen.
You had a beautiful moment right there.
I was nice and silent, but yeah. Well, what's interesting is I had an opposite reaction for the same reason. I thought that everything that had been done to Luke, and then to bring him back as what I saw as a puppet that was supposed to be a fake. Like it's supposed to entertain me. It's supposed to distract me from the fact that it's all dead. He's like a corpse being waddled around.
The way I saw that was the opposite of how you literally that Jon Favreau and Dave Filoni came in, two people who were like, "What the f was the Last Jedi? It's shit." And literally, because what I had heard was that a lot of those people, a lot of the big names, really hated that movie and they thought it was such garbage. But you know they can't say anything because they work at Lucasfilm, so. It was nice to see, and I was just like, okay, cool. They're actually now taking the reins back. The power is back in the hands of, you know, what George wanted. And all of that accumulated, and I'm like, okay, this is freaking emotional as hell.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be his redemption.
Oh, yeah, and then it wasn't.
Back into the canon. Yeah, and then it was just a wisp of smoke.
Literally, like, training Grogu for 2 seconds, and then...
And then he hands Grogu back.
Ubers him back.
But I think I brought this up on a previous open bar where I think... When it comes to certain pieces of media, we attach meaning to it that maybe goes beyond even what the writers might have intended. Oh, yeah. And you know, whether it's like we associate it with a certain time period in our lives or a certain person or like something that gives it like a real emotional resonance that goes beyond just like what the writers did. Mm-hmm. And I just, this is where it gets into difficult territory because, you know, like Mauler's saying, like if you just break it down into the nuts and bolts of the writing and the payoff and the setup for like Luke showing up at that moment, there's not really anything there, but like it can mean a lot to people because of the meta around Star Wars at that time and then what Luke means to them as a person. And then it gets into difficult territory of like, well, how then do I assess how effective this is? Because it's reducing people to tears, but then it's because it means something to that specific person for specific reasons.
Yeah, and then we've got to reflect that onto all the people that are in those clips saying, oh my God, it's a red lightsaber. They can sometimes cry when they see that shit. And it's like, everyone's entitled to their reaction, but everyone's entitled to their reaction to the reactions.
Right.
It's a whole plethora. Humanity is complicated and messy. I I find that it's all been rather fun and enlightening to figure out what everyone believes Star Wars is. I've been seeing tweets, and if you follow me on Twitter, you've been seeing me fighting with them all day. People saying shit like, you know, the Acolyte covers a subject that George didn't manage to fully cover. Like, you know, when Mace is fighting Palpatine and there's a lot of moral ambiguity as to whether or not he should stop Palpatine, the Acolyte has taken that for... I was like, what?
What?
Like, what? And you get this thing of the shitting on the OT and all this, and you're just like, what did everyone think Star Wars was? What's
yeah. Well, or even that actor, first of all, he gets it wrong, right? But he says, oh, Anakin destroyed the Death Star. And I told my friend that he's a big, big Star Wars fan. When I told him that, he actually just like put his head, bowed down his head in shame. He's like, what is going on?
It's unacceptable.
Wait. I think I've got this, though. I think indirectly Anakin did destroy the Death Star because he took Palpatine, threw him down the reactor shaft, right? I think it was him getting thrown down the reactor shaft that destroyed the Death Star. It wasn't the reactor itself getting blown up by the Millennium Falcon. It's
yeah, possible. That was more of like a passing thing. They had several reactors in there. It was fine.
Yeah. I mean, that blue energy smoke that came out.
Luke is just standing there like, am I a joke to you guys?
That Death Star had several stomachs. It's fine.
maybe the Yord guy was right. You know? And you know, I can't
millions of people, isn't trillions. He bad?
I can't even blame that actor for saying that, because I, you know, watching a few interviews with Leslie, it kind of seems like this is a common theme that she's been purporting to her actors and to people, being like, well, you just look at the show, like, there is no point of view of this show. Literally, it's taking the point of view of the witches, of the Jedi, of Osha, of Mei, of Kylo, Smilo. And she's probably pushed this on everyone, be like, the point of the show is that everyone has a point of view and no one is really good or bad. We want to look at all aspects. Like, this is her brainwashing people who don't understand Star Wars to her actors. It's unfortunate.
The thing is, that's not an entirely invalid premise if you're a smart writer. Like, you can show multiple perspectives on a situation or, you know, the philosophy of the world that this, you know, story takes place in. That can work, but you have to be smart about how you do it. You have to like show these different perspectives as being valid and justify them morally.
Yeah,
the Acolyte fails horribly at all of that stuff. Like, it portrays the villains as heroes and the heroes as villains.
Well, it's the weird shipping of the Smilo and Osha is just strange, because you literally have a guy like who's a murderer kidnapping this girl to a private island. I mean, it sounds kind of familiar. and then being all like explicit with her and like nude. Like, he knew she was there. He knew she was going to follow him. He like just drops his clothes, goes into the pond for 2 seconds, and he's like, are you going to take it or some shit, whatever he said.
Yeah. It's like, no, he's like, it feels good to hold it, doesn't it?
Yeah, what the fuck, man?
And he's like, well, if you're not going to come in.
Yeah, if you're not going to turn, then let me put my clothes on. Gets out, doesn't put his clothes on for like 5 minutes, and she just takes a couple peeks, and it's like, what the fuck are we watching? What is this? This is like, just so weird. Like, could you imagine Qui-Gon doing some shit like that with like Padme or something?
This is like a show. This is like a Star Wars show written by the same people who would do like a Harry Potter fanfic where Draco Malfoy gets with Hermione or something, like, because like the bad boy
Who read a ton of those types of fan fictions. That's exactly what this is.
No, I'd be more like Draco gets with Harry or something.
But I thought she was a lesbian. I thought Osha is a lesbian. Didn't they hint at that with her sexual tension with
bisexual. Why not?
Yeah, bisexual. Why am I putting her into a box?
Maybe she's bisexual.
She's omnisexual. Okay, she just goes for everything.
How dare you try to pinpoint her sexuality?
Leslie Headland said that the whole premise here was like, you know, true love can exist between sisters, and I thought, I don't think you considered the implications of that when you said it, Leslie. That's not what we're after.
Yeah, it's too much.
But yeah, she's like, Osha and Mei love each other, I suppose, possibly a bit too much, but yeah. It's so tiring. It's quite the experience. And next week is the final episode.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Then it'll be over. And then, like, what's the next Star Wars thing that's going to come out?
Somehow we act light return. You just think it's over.
Next up will be Skeleton Crew, is it?
Oh,
oh,
God.
Is that, so that's live action, isn't it?
Yeah, Jude Law's in it.
Really?
Like, how? Nothing's been said about this at all. Like, I feel there's been no marketing for it, nothing.
We'll see, I guess. And then I'm assuming after that it'll be Andor season two, which that's going to be a real interesting time.
That's because I think the audience for Andor has probably grown a little bit since it actually came out. Like, I feel like people have slowly cottoned on to it being quite good.
You do see a lot about it here and there. And generally people who found it to be so boring they quit have gone from saying that to, but I've heard people say it's good. Which is fair, because that's what you do here.
Progress, I suppose.
I mean, well, I don't mean that there's nothing wrong with that. You can say that it was boring, because it absolutely was to a lot of people. But I'm just saying that, like, it's generally seen more favorably than it was in its first few weeks, as I think you just pointed out.
It's so frustrating. It's like the one thing they've made that's actually quite good. No one watches it.
Yeah.
Fucking hell.
I just saw Jeremy's tweet. One of the most viral stories on YouTube right now is whether Boogie2988 lied about having cancer in order to scam his fans for money. But people making hate videos on the Acolyte is what's ruining the purity of YouTube. What is this?
I would go as far as to, I for some reason know everything about this story. So
what has Boogie been doing?
Confirmed. So Boogie had polycythemia, secondary polycythemia caused by the fact that he had increased red blood cells because he was so fat that he was unable to breathe properly when sleeping, which causes the body to compensate with more red blood cells, which combined with testosterone supplements can have a negative effect of causing a potential result that is the same result you can get from having a blood cancer or something like that. And the theory goes that the doctor told him he had that, and that there is a version of it that is cancerous, and that he claims to have the cancerous one, but that with enough poking from enough people, I think it was actually Destiny who confronted him on a stream. He wanted proof because he believes he's using the one that's not caused by the cancer as the one that is the cancer, and then Boogie refused to show his records. Yeah. And it got really suspicious. And the more time went on, Destiny said, if you show me the record and prove it, I will pay you $5,000 toward your medical bills. Because Boogie's been complaining about it. And he said, no. Then another YouTuber came on and said she'll pay fully for his trip to Disneyland. And that's plus the $5,000.
That'll cure him.
Then Mutaha said he'll pay $10,000 along with that other $5,000 along with a trip to Disneyland. He still refused. And I think the final offer from Mutaha was $50,000 to simply show the record that said he had the cancer, and he refused.
Should have said like $50,000 plus all you can eat at the Golden Corral forever.
Plus Disney World.
For the record, you need to understand, he was willing to engage in a crypto scam for his audience to get paid $10,000, but he won't show a medical record that doesn't have to show anything revealing other than the confirmation of polycythemia vera, I think is what he had to show, and he refused for $50,000. So the going assumption here, there's no definitive proof, but the going assumption is he lied and he doesn't have any proof.
Wow.
See, I was quite neutral on Boogie for a long time. I didn't really like
that was your mistake.
And then, like, you know, we watched the fight that he had with Wings of Redemption, and I was like, okay, I can kind of, you know, you were clearly a fucking joke in the ring, but at least you had the guts to climb into the ring with another man and get beaten up. So that's something. But then you see stuff like this and realize, nah, you're just a piece of shit. Like,
also, the reason I know this is I'm a partial Boogie historian. It's not for anything else. I just keep track of that man. He is he is an absolute calamity. I described him as like there would have to be a new circle of hell in Dante's Inferno to account for him. Like the series of things he's done to his fans is absolutely insane. He's lied more than anyone I've known on this platform. And the idea that his final act before being booted off the internet is to have tried to grift his audience into thinking he had cancer for sympathy is just perfect. That's exactly what I would expect.
That is low. That is about as low as it gets.
But it's so funny because he's been claiming for so long. Destiny was just the first person to say, prove it. And then suddenly it became a thing of like, why won't you prove it? And then he was like, what do you mean? I don't need to prove it. Oh, shit.
I watched the documentary, and that was probably like a mistake as well. Like the one they did last year, I think, about Boogie. And it was like, it was so bad that the filmmaker himself had to be like, I need to take a break from this fucking guy because he's like depressing the shit out of me.
Really?
Who is
he? Yeah, it was like, because as far as I understand, Boogie's entire life is just wallowing in this pit of self-pity and just like, oh, my life is awful and it's like not my fault at all. And it seems like most of his problems are entirely self-inflicted. And even the documentary filmmaker was like, no, I'm fucking sick of him. I need to do something else. I need to find another angle on this because it's so fucking hard to talk to this guy.
God.
That's next level.
It's like an energy vampire.
Well, it is.
He got a woman out of prostitution because her experience of sleeping with Boogie like was enough to get her out
of being a
sex worker forever.
Are you serious?
Oh my god.
It was so horrific. I'm only telling you what was in the documentary, man.
Holy shit.
So does that count like as positive in his like karma?
He accomplished something good indirectly.
He,
at one point, there's so many clips. Boogie is a fucking disaster. He'll always try and turn every single failure he has into some kind of selfless act. And he'll be like, those hookers I hired, they paid to put their children through school. So it's like, what the fuck? He's like, I put children into education, you know. Like, I'm helping.
Oh, okay.
There is not a low he won't hit. Like I said, his last two big acts was crypto scam on his audience, and then lying to them that he had cancer. He on his latest stream, I don't know if this is true. I would guess not, but he said he's not coming back to the internet after this one.
Really? So
Yeah,
that's what he said. Well, just think about it, right? When you're offered what is essentially $65,000 to provide a medical record that you're arguing is true, there is no reason not to do that.
Yeah.
Because he needs the money. He's desperately said he had to do the crypto scam because he couldn't afford his medical bills to stay alive. Someone's offering $65,000. But the thing
is, just say you lied.
You don't get the money. So like that's the requirement, is it has to be true and proven to get the $65,000.
Interesting.
So you're saying I shouldn't send him a saber? Well,
so no. he's trapped, and you can tell that from the stream. His two options are to tell the truth, which would destroy his entire reputation forever, or to just keep the lie going and leave.
It wouldn't. People would forgive him. Look what happened with Liver King.
I don't know about this. His reputation's pretty bad, but this one, like, it would follow him forever. It would follow him more than Mundane Matt got followed for the Boulder shit, right?
That's wild.
So did he ask, you said he asked people for money to help him pay for his cancer treatment? Like, how much has he gotten?
I can't remember if there was a direct request of pay me to help me with my cancer medication, but he did say that he did the crypto scam on his audience to pay for his medical shit. Arguably, I think worse than asking them to support his medical bills.
I agree.
Because you're...
yeah. There's countless clips of him saying he didn't scam anybody because everyone knows that you're not supposed to support those coins.
Why is he famous?
Because he pretended to be a good person for so many years.
He came along in the early days of YouTube when it was like, you know, like it wasn't Smosh as refined as it is now. Yeah, and it was like he was a funny sort of video game reviewer, and like he had this alter ego of like a fat, like geeky guy with a lisp, basically, and he did lots of funny skits and stuff. And I think, from what I understand, he was quite engaging in his early days, and he just came across as this like kind of likable geek, I suppose.
He was always pity me. I've had a very, very difficult life, and I'm just trucking along trying to do my thing. Oh, here's a video game that's come out. I'm going to talk about that. Oh, here's. Do you remember when he went to VidCon or whatever, and he talked about how Anita Sarkeesian bullied him?
Yeah, she gave him panic attacks and stuff.
Yeah. Like, if you go back to those videos comparing him to now, it was just all a lie. Like,
why the fuck was he on a panel with Anita Sarkeesian anyway?
He got the award for, like, the best internet personality of 2018 or 19 or something.
Ooh, that didn't age well.
It's, Well, no, it's absolutely not. He's completely shredded his whole audience. Everyone's making videos about how he's the worst person in the world. You don't lie to your audience to get money about cancer. That's like, that's one of the go-to examples.
We shouldn't have to be telling you this stuff, Boogie.
No.
Don't pretend to have a terminal illness so you can get grift money off people. That's the bad thing to do.
That's crazy. It reminds me of like, Leslie Headland said, you know, my core writing idea in this show is there's a twin and then there's an evil twin. That's a new idea. Storytelling, like, what are you doing?
No, it's more like when she was at Star Wars Celebration and someone asked her, like, what does Star Wars mean to you? And she's like, Star Wars saved my life. No, it didn't. I refuse to believe that in any way, shape, or form.
The tears.
Star Wars is a payday for you. And it's a platform. That's all it is.
It's going to be her undoing the way this show is going.
Oh, yeah. Let me ask you guys, though. Did you guys enjoy Gladiator? That movie from the early 2000s? It was quite good, I thought.
They never made a sequel, right? That's nuts.
Yeah, they did. They released a trailer for it. And wow, I can only play you small segments of it because of the copyright issue and stuff. But man, it just goes in hard right off the bat.
I remember that day.
See, this is a little flashback to a much better movie. And I
remember.
Yeah, do you remember? I just think back to the Russell Crowe interviews where he's like, stop asking me about this fucking movie. I'm not even in it. I'm dead. I don't know anything about it.
You could be a force ghost. You never know.
Sure, yeah, let's go with that.
I never forgot it. That a slave could take revenge against an emperor.
Where were you born?
Connie Nielsen's still looking pretty good these days, though. Like, she's 20 years older than she was in the original. Doing well.
Nice one.
I don't know. I never knew a mother nor a father.
You will be my instrument.
Who are you?
Denzel. I'm kind of curious as to what his role in this is.
Yeah.
People seem to know he's some kind of... Is it a slave that got freed or that he bought his way out or something or fought his way out?
Yeah, he was definitely a slave at some point. Like, was he a gladiator himself and then he earned his freedom, maybe?
Don't know.
Yeah.
But he's obviously got good designs to overthrow the emperor and take his place, perhaps? I mean, that's the impression I got from this because, like, he seems to be fermenting a rebellion of his own or a revolution, as you see later in the trailer.
Did you hear that crowd?
The greatest temple Rome ever built. The Colosseum.
That is actually real. They did that. The Colosseum was designed so that you could fill it with water and then they would have naval battles going on. Which is
I haven't seen this yet.
Do they do any space battles in this era?
Funnily enough, no. And like, I was as disappointed as you actually when I found out they didn't
you
do
see
that,
the Colosseum opening up and a missile is in the center of it.
Like a fucking Star Destroyer just rises up out the water.
Yeah, also, why is Pedro Pascal in everything now? He's in everything.
I can't explain it.
I don't think he'll last long in this. I think he's the bad guy.
Oh, really?
I think he's gonna be the final boss fight, isn't he?
Yeah, but I wonder how much of a villain he is, because there's a few lines that he gives later on where he's actually lamenting like how corrupt Rome is and how they sacrifice so many innocent lives just for bread and circuses, basically. Which makes me wonder, like, is he going to turn into a good man?
I hope not. This?
Is he going to have to team up with the goody? I'm not sure.
Maybe.
Yeah, I just feel like there's more to him than that.
Because this is what they believe.
There he is. Oh, sorry.
Power.
That's not exactly a hallmark of quality at this point, director Ridley Scott. I hope it's better than Napoleon. Put it that way.
Yeah.
General Acacius.
There are victories yet still to come.
Rome has so many subjects, she must feed them.
They can eat war!
You guys ever eaten war?
It's got like a tangy sort of wooden taste.
The calorie content. Yeah, the calorie content is not as high as you might think.
The arena turns slaves into gladiators, the gladiators into free men.
You have something in you. I knew it from the start.
Did you now?
Rage.
By the way, they've got gladiatrixes in this one.
Yeah.
I believe that's the technical term, which is interesting because they were never really a thing. I'm sure this movie's going to make them into a thing, but they were never really verified to even exist. From what I've read, they were kind of on the level of like having dwarves fight each other with swords. Like they were kind of a novelty if they were ever used. So, but I'm sure they'll be like the best fighters ever in this one.
Yeah.
For modern audiences.
And wage is your gift.
This is about survival!
Hello, Rhino.
Yeah, it's a war rhino. Like, if Wakanda can do it, then ancient Rome could do it, I reckon. I'm going to skip forward slightly because I don't want to show too much of it just purely because of copyright.
Yeah.
It's just a music.
Here it is. For sure. Yeah.
I need to only give it a push.
We make it out alive. All right, all right.
I just have to ask you guys. You guys are younger than me. And you can probably clue me in on what the youngins are listening to these days. Like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah, well, it's not that.
This song is a few years old anyway.
Yeah.
I know, but like, if I tried to pair up this with like an ancient Roman gladiatorial epic movie, I probably wouldn't pick a song like this.
Yeah, they're like, oh, Denzel's in it, so we got to put a rap song in it.
Yeah.
That's what's irritating people. It's like a lot of times when you put black people in something, all of a sudden now, it's a hip hop song when it's not called for. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They did it with the Black Panther trailer.
Yeah.
And they did it with something else that just came out. Yasuke. People were mad because they were playing like they had like a trap rap music beat and he was fighting. And it's like, why can't y'all just make it authentic? Why you gotta throw rap on everything that we do? So a lot of people are irritated with
it. I've seen the claim that people
don't like... Well, he's black, so we got to put rap music in. So.
Yeah. I've seen the claim that they put it in for that reason, so it's racist, but I've also seen the counterclaim that you don't like it because you're racist. It just feels like the Spider-Man meme of everyone racist of this trailer.
I just love the idea as well of like the soundtrack guys going to Ridley Scott, like 87-year-old man, and be like, so this is the track we want to layer on this one, man. It's gonna be bitching. And this like old confused Scottish guy just being like, oh yeah, okay, if you think so.
Yeah. But it's like Kamala Harris. She recorded that video talking about reproductive rights, and she's talking to a black woman. She goes, I'm out here on the streets, girl. They not like us. It's like, come on.
I get a reaction to that. It's the most inauthentic. I'm black and cool type of crap you ever want to see. I did a reaction. It's horrible.
His the reason I think he's evil is because his armor is a lot like Commodus's.
Well, he's a general in the Roman army. We know that much about him. But then there's a scene where he's fighting other gladiators. Well, it's actually this one, I'm pretty sure. So,
but then he was the emperor or some shit wearing white. So is he like supposed to be Maximus? Reborn, kind of, and then he gets, you know,
I think
of the people.
The emperor seems insane, so it makes me wonder if that's going to be Nero. But see.
Okay.
As far as I'm aware, because I've seen people discussing it, they've got a lot of information about who these characters are. I haven't remembered it. Obviously, I'll check it out on the day.
Yes. Pedro Pascal plays Marcus Acacius, a Roman general who trained under Maximus. He leads an army to take over North Africa. According to Pascal, he is a very, very good general. Okay, okay. Nice one. Thanks for that, Pedro.
Perfect. I'm sorry. Is it very good or very, very good?
Very, very,
very good. Oh, like, okay. Just a very good general.
Important difference.
You can't put three varies in there. It's a little too over.
Dead to Washington. He plays Macrinus, a power broker who keeps a stable of gladiators. He works as an arms dealer and provides food and oil. Oil? Yeah, there's a lot of fucking like engines that you have to fuel in Roman times.
In the Roman
the armies of Europe. Scott described him as pretty fucking cruel. Okay. Sure. Good enough for me. And then Joseph Quinn, he's the Emperor Gaeta. So yeah, he's not Nero, but He didn't want to be compared to Joaquin Phoenix's performance as Commodus. He says that he wanted to play the chords louder and turn it up and go for the more brave and bold form of communication. Like, I don't know, screaming. He also credited Connie Nielsen for helping him and the rest of the cast not be nervous about the film's legacy because she's old. So that made it easier, I suppose. But, yeah, I mean... I look at this film and I just think, one, it's made by Ridley Scott, who's like slowly destroying his own legacy by continuing to make films right now. Two, it's a sequel that no one wanted to a film that like wrapped its story up pretty conclusively 20 years ago. And three, the trailer just looks kind of shit. Yeah. I don't know, man. I don't have much to get excited about with this one.
The Gladiator is my favorite movie. I haven't really watched this trailer because I'm just...
Sorry, I had to put you through it.
Yeah, they should have did the sequel a while ago.
Yeah, they should have done it like 15 years ago.
They were going to. It's like you're not James. Not everybody's James Cameron and can pull sequels off years later and really make it a hit.
Right.
If you're Ridley Scott at this point in your life, you kind of just have to like shit out as many films as you can before you die because he's pretty old. He's not going to be around too much longer. I just can't imagine even making films at this point in my life, or like that point in my life, sorry, when I'm pushing like mid-80s.
Yeah, I wonder why some people don't. I mean, Tarantino has the right approach, right? He's just going to make his movies and he has one left and that's it. He's done. Like that, you can just focus on the quality and then call it. And this is just, I don't know. People should know when to just turn away from something.
So really, really weird connection here. People in chat wanted to make sure it was understood. There was plenty of uses for oil in Roman times. And one of the main ones I kept seeing repeated was olive oil. And then I spotted someone else saying something and I just checked it. I don't know if you guys know, but Shelley Duvall portrayed olive oil.
And, she recently passed away today.
Yeah, R.I.P. She's like, this is a bizarre connection. But all right. It was just seeing them back to back, you know? Because I didn't know. But yeah, that's sad.
It is sad. I mean, like, no one but Shelley Duvall could have played olive oil in
Pulp. I am inclined to agree.
She had, I think it was the shape of her head that was just the perfect one for olive oil. Yeah, I mean, fantastic actress, obviously. Like, everyone remembers her from The Shining and went through some tough times to get that film made. Apparently, yeah, Stanley Kubrick was a right prick towards her, but. Managed to coax a pretty incredible performance out of her at the same time. So I guess it worked out okay. But yeah. 75. Yeah. Did they say what she died from or anything? Or
no, I didn't see anything. Maybe it's not out yet, I don't know.
Yeah. Oh well. Sad, but there you go. Before we finish up for today, my panel, should we do a few super chats?
Yeah.
Complications from diabetes.
Oh, really?
The Thursday in her sleep. Complications from diabetes. Yeah.
She was 75.
Yeah.
Well, there you go.
And diabetes involves a bunch of different stuff, so who knows what it was.
Yeah. Okay. There's one for you from Joshua. Some of Ridley Scott interviews for the movie ought to be good. Yeah, his... I don't know if you guys have ever seen the behind the scenes commentary for Alien, but man, it is wild when he talks. I can't even say it here on stream because I'll probably get demonetized. But yeah, when he's talking about the bit where Sigourney Weaver's in her underwear right at the end of the movie and how she refused to pull up her underwear for the scene. Someone had to digitally alter it frame by frame. Like, that was
really
all I can say is look up the quote, man.
Is it because of hair?
Yeah.
You know what? No, I thought that because in Aliens, when they all, you know, wake up, she's got hair poking out the sides.
Yeah. I never noticed that, actually, but there you go.
Yep, I did.
But yeah, she refused to shave, and she wouldn't, like, wear better underwear or anything that would hide it. So someone had to digitally remove all the hair frame by frame.
That's funny.
God. That must have been a wild set.
Like, just pull them up. Like, why are you being so difficult with this?
Yeah, that's I don't know weird. What she expected to get out of it. It was the 70s, man. What can I say?
Yeah.
Did you know Nick Gillard was the alien?
No, I didn't. That's cool.
No.
Yeah, he was telling me. He was the actual alien in the suit on the, what is it, in the, the hangar.
Yeah. That's good stuff.
Wild.
So the first of the super chats here is from Grimnak, who's been a member for 9 months. So welcome, sir. I know this is super random, but I won a karaoke competition in my state, and now I get a free trip to Vegas for nationals. Top six go to Finland for world. Okay. I don't know what to say to that one, but yeah, congratulations. Well done. Godzilla's Greaser says, Drinker, favorite boss theme from the Resident Evil franchise. Mine are the themes for Alexia from Code Veronica and DSC. So, yeah, favorite boss battle themes from the Resident Evil series might be Tyrant from Resident Evil 2, like when it shows up in the second scenario and it's like on fire and you have to fight it before you get the rocket launcher. That is some wild shit right there. It's good stuff. Bruno Corbella says, has anyone seen A Quiet Place Day One? I thought it was quite good. It's easily the best one. It's the Godzilla minus one of the series in a way. Hmm. Have you guys seen it?
Nope.
Yes, no.
Any good? Yeah. Better than the first one?
No, not to me. But
no?
Okay. Yeah.
The first one was so good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll just stay quiet on that one.
Haven't seen them.
I did there.
I don't know why I've never seen the Quiet Place movies. I just
really,
yeah, they were. You would like it.
At least the first one, man.
I saw the first two. I think it was. It was okay.
The first one's, Drinker, I think you would like it. You too, MauLer. It's good. Yeah.
I don't think MauLer would.
You've seen it and you don't like it. Is that it?
It's one of the most overrated movies in history.
MauLer, you're supposed to wait like 5 minutes before you tell me that you hate something.
I'm sorry.
You just destroy art, MauLer. We know that's what you do. Huey, did you share something there you want to show people?
I did. I would love to show people, yeah. It's just I was just looking at the comments. The Star Wars posted, actions have consequences. Episode 7 of The Acolyte, and then the comments are just... the consequences of just really wanting to go home. Waiting for them to turn off the comments. Horrible shows that are propaganda purposes. Like this post is of all their posts is getting flamed the most, and it's wild. So y'all can have a look at your own discretion. But what did you do? Oh, man. Oh, geez. Yeah. Anyways,
Nerdrotic made that connection between Saul's interest in the children and then how Obi-Wan Kenobi looked at Leia, and he's like, "You're 10 years old, but you won't always be."
Oh no!
Yeah.
Creepy. Oh, it's so weird.
Oh no.
That's what rough. Are they trying to tell us?
Why do you need to say that?
Yeah. Anyways.
That was pretty good. I like that one. next one here is Human16533 says, I asked my work buddy if he knew what Acolyte was about, and he said, lesbian Jedis that make babies with the magic. Thank you, Disney. It's good enough for
Perfect.
Me.
Perfect. Perfect.
It's the funny thing is, like, a premise like that seems like fuel for 1,000 Pornhub videos, but like, it's just the reality of it is less interesting. Mm. Rossi gifted 5 critical drinker memberships. So thank you, sir.
Oh, Rossi.
That one guy says, what if, and hear me out, this is about a gifted bunch of Jedi, the short bus kind. They weren't supposed to find anything. Well, that could be, yeah. Oh, I think that's the writers rather than the characters.
Yeah.
T1S says, you guys did Gandalf versus Magneto. How about Wizard On versus Wizard Off from the Lord of the Rings Gollum? Inquiring minds want to know.
I think it was like, it was whether or not they were on the screen, but the subtitles just read stuff like Wizard On, Wizard Off before saying things. So like, what does that mean? Wizard Off.
It's like, yeah, it's like the Karate Kid, like Wizard On, Wizard Off.
My assumption is Wizard On would take Wizard Off easily. He's got it on, you know, everything's going.
Yeah, I think so, yeah. You turn your wizard powers on. That's how it works. PB Magic says, what can kill Star Wars? The power of one? No. The power of two? No. The power of many, many bad Star Wars shows? Looks like.
Yeah.
I think you might be right. It's slowly killing it.
And they clearly used, for the vocalizing, they clearly used an Indian woman to do some of the background vocals. And I was just so pissed. I'm like, why do you got to bring Indian style of singing into this? Like, leave us out of this, please.
Did they?
If they had turned this into a Bollywood dance number, I would genuinely have been more entertained. I think that would have been pretty cool.
Especially if the Wookiee was like front and center doing the dance moves with them.
It's when like they're doing this somber scene and then like some random extra in the background just goes like, nah!
But they just like copy paste the same sound file twice. Did you see that?
Yeah.
That was so weird. I had to rewind. I was like, who the hell said that? It was so jarring.
Yeah.
It's like, give us something that seems vaguely tribal or something. Like, yeah, sure, that'll do.
Yeah. And leave us Indians out of tribal nonsense. That's not what our 10,000-year-old history is about. You can't just put us into like a tribal mix that's same with like American Native Americans. We're totally different.
In Disney's mind, you're all the same. That's the thing.
So irritating. It is. This is one of those really weird things, is that Indians who come to America then like have completely connected with like the wokest of the woke ideology and feel like they're part of that same story. And it's just like, can you come up with your own? Why are you melting your identity into all of that? Like, we have our own story. We have our own individual experience of things. Why are you picking up just like what's a popular thing to talk about? It's like, no, we're not oppressed.
Because it's North America.
Yeah.
I was going to say, because it's weird. In Britain, it's the opposite. Like, Indians who immigrated to the UK, like, you know, 50s, 60s, 70s, like, they were the most, like, conservative that you could find. Like, they were kind of anti all that stuff, and they had no tolerance for any of that bullshit. But
it's the kids. I think the kids then take, you know, the children of the immigrants take a very sort of opposite view. And then the Americans that have come here to America, we have the highest income. Like, the median household income is the highest amongst Indian Americans. Like, we are not oppressed. It's okay. Like, you can.
It's like, we're doing well.
Yeah. Like, and this land gave us the opportunity to do that. You can just embrace that and be proud of it. It's okay. You don't have to cultivate some victim narrative.
Stephen DeLeon said, shout out to West Texas. Yeah. Good on you, West Texas. La Parca says, how do you think Tony Gilroy would handle a lightsaber duel and the use of the Force?
I'd hope he'd hire the right people to properly fucking choreograph it. What else can I say? I don't know. I assume he, unlike some people, sees an opportunity in a fight sequence to actually like display characteristics. I feel like you get that in Andor. A lot of the standard gun fights or whatever have you, they give opportunities for different characters to suddenly die, sort of highlighting the brutality, but then also other characters to move into places or to do certain things that show something about themselves. But man, like, I saw someone sharing the Kelnaka versus the two of them fight and saying like the choreography is incredible, and I was just saying like, you must be joking. Like, what's happened?
It's like, I when see you that feel all the time. Oh man,
when you don't even account for the fact that a Wookiee is like five times stronger than either of them, like, yeah, you're not working the characteristics.
She has no understanding of how powerful a Wookiee is. Like, literally, a Wookiee could pull your arms off just by standing there.
Nah, yeah. Mate, Stole can take him in a fight, a fist fight. It's so beyond.
And Dara can flip him over by being on his head. Like, that wouldn't do nothing to him. We in the script for Vader, we have a Wookiee that fights Vader, and that will be an accurate fight for fighting the most powerful cybernetic Sith Lord in existence.
Okay.
But theory, Torben really wanted to get home, so he was really emboldened.
I have to finish Elden Ring. I gotta get home right now.
It's like, gotta
get back to Coruscant. Mom's
making pancakes.
Yeah, literally. I think I left the oven on. Shit.
Yuri, this Wookiee, is he a lesbian or?
I don't know. I can't confirm or deny his sexual preference.
Why does he wear clothes and then sometimes he doesn't? Is he a nudist?
I just want to know what he was searching for with that metal detector, man.
Moss. More moss.
Someone in the comments said racism.
Guys, I think the ground over here is pretty racist. I don't know. What you're saying about this.
The racism count is over 9,000. Never seen anything like this.
Hey, before. Soul, there's a vergence in the Force in this hole. I think we should go check it out.
I wish they'd given Torben some like really ridiculous backstory and just said like, oh, he has to get home to like feed his cat or something.
His goldfish.
Something that makes no sense. No,
he's got to get more hair plugs or something, like, and then he didn't do it, and that's how he ended up the way he is.
Poor Torben.
I just feel bad for that actor, man. It's like we humiliated him in every way possible.
Poor guy.
Derek, a question for all of us. What do you think of the Telltale Adventure games? I like them to play once, but then after that, yeah, don't replay them because then you'll see how non-choicey they are. But it's the same with all games like that, basically. Alex Jordan says, who knew the witch's weakness was in the Wookiee the whole time? Well, yeah.
Hmm.
So, you take him out, then you kill them all.
Apparently.
Discordian says, RIP Shelley Duvall. I'll be watching The Shining tonight in tribute to her. That is a pretty good way to spend the evening. Peter Garombi says, if Biggest Dickus isn't in Gladiator 2, then it's a hard pass for me. If the movie fails, it'll be for the lack of Biggest Dickus. I think that's reasonable. Yeah. And Jordan Pendragon says, in 2003, the American Film Institute created the top 100 greatest cinematic heroes and villains list. Obi-Wan appears at number 37 and then Han Solo at number 14. Meanwhile, Luke Skywalker doesn't appear at all.
Wow.
That can't be right, surely. Are we going by coolness factor or what? Yeah, he must be there, surely. This is 2003 as well, before everything went different.
Shite.
Yeah. Before we go on with a few more super chats, I know, Tyrone, you're just about out of time here, so I wanted to say thank you, sir, for joining us tonight.
Thanks for having me, as usual. You know,
pleasure as always, man. Thank you.
Nice to stream with you, Tyrone.
Yeah, no problem.
We brought Theory and Tyrone together on stream for the first time ever as well. That's never happened.
That's pretty dope.
Is this our first time?
This is our first time
together.
Yep.
Oh. Yeah.
We've reacted to each other's reactions. That's the closest we ever got. And then now this, we're like,
finally.
Star-crossed.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. You gotta go the other way.
Oh, wait. This way.
Yeah.
It's really hard to get cameras reversed, isn't it?
One day.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Tyrone. I appreciate it, man. And I will look forward to catching up with you again sometime soon.
All right, no problem. Everybody take care.
See you, dude. Thanks, man.
All right, bye.
I will do a few more super chats before wrapping it up this evening. Simon Ho says, the laundering of one, the laundering of two, and the laundering of many.
Of 180 million.
Oh, yeah. Metalface Rosie says, if Lucas had convinced Spielberg, Ron Howard, and Joe Johnson to direct the prequels, which movie would you want each one of them to direct? So... Ooh, yeah. I think I'd want Spielberg for the third one, for Revenge of the Sith. I feel like he could bring that gravitas. Ron Howard, he's a pretty like reliable, solid director, but not like particularly spectacular. He's a middle guy, maybe like Attack of the Clones. And yeah, perhaps Joe Johnson to kick things off.
I don't know. What's Joe Johnson done?
So,
you're Captain America, right? Or am I mixing that up?
I don't know who he is.
Yeah, so he has done Jurassic Park 3, Hidalgo, The Wolfman, Captain America, Not Safe for Work, and The Nutcracker. So yeah, probably his biggest, you know, movies are going to be Jurassic Park 3 and Captain America.
Right.
Did you guys like the first Captain America?
Yeah.
It didn't initially, but it's grown on me over the years.
It's all right.
I think it's got a wonderful charm.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's, again, it falls into that like category of movies that perhaps weren't that amazing for their time, but then in light of how shit the franchise has gotten, I look back on it really fondly now.
What's the deal with Avengers 5, guys? Are they bringing everyone back?
Whatever.
Captain America.
It's complete disaster. They need to figure out how people are going to react to all these next set of shit that's coming out, especially Captain America, Captain Falcon, whatever that
Captain
is.
Captain Black America, Falcon Man.
It's that's going to be a
big order.
Because we don't know, and they don't know, who the Avengers are. I'm sure they don't even have a surefire contract on a lot of these actors. At this point, obviously, like, it's like Benedict Cumberbatch's Doctor Strange is like their biggest hitter. And he's almost the only main they have. Because like even Brie Larson's Captain Marvel, she's got way less leverage now after what happened with the Marvels. So like, what?
You're going to find Brie Larson working in a toll booth in a couple of years.
That's the thing. She's not going to want to. I don't get the impression she even likes playing Captain Marvel. So I don't know what's going to happen, man.
Do they still have Hemsworth? Or is he out?
Well, you know as well as I do, he's made comments saying he's not really interested in playing Thor unless it's handled by someone who wants to give a substantive sort of story for him, which is so fucking sad, by the way. There's not a writer worth their salt at all that's going to look after his character.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like Hemsworth is really getting any other types of roles that are really taking off, right?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. No. Extraction done pretty well, right?
Extraction.
It is in relative terms. It's not like setting the box office on fire or anything. Because like, it went to streaming straight away, didn't it? So, I mean, it's a neat little franchise, but it's like...
I think he's doing all right. Like, the Dementis role was kind of fun for him, even though Furiosa flopped, right?
That's the problem, isn't it? It's not going to help his career, that, unfortunately.
Right.
I don't know. I don't see him having any trouble getting roles, especially compared to someone like Brie Larson, who I don't even know if she is getting roles. Like, I don't know if she's in anything. Yeah. I know she had her own TV show, right? Chemistry, or something in Chemistry, I think.
Yeah. But, loved by literally dozens.
Point being, who will be in the Avengers? No one knows. Not even the director and writer of that fucking movie. No, Disney do not know.
They lost Kang, so that was going to be the main villain.
Yeah.
Unless they do a recasting.
I think it's safe to assume they will spam as much as they can everything that you could possibly imagine across the Deadpool Wolverine movie and then the Avengers movies.
I hope that'll be good. When's it out? Next week?
Something like that, yeah. 2 weeks.
All right, cool.
I think it's fascinating, though, like how no one talks about the MCU anymore. Like, obviously, we're talking about it right now because we were asked a direct question about it. But like, there's no lingering.
The truth is, there is Disney Marvel content. There is no MCU anymore. Nothing's connected.
No.
There's no running story. There's nothing that's being built up. Kang's gone.
You got Agatha.
Nothing.
Is that guy in jail?
No, but I don't think they're not going to be using anything. He's been dropped, right? So there's no expectation of a Kang. I don't even know about a Kang recast. There is no continuity to be excited about. Agatha is the next thing, and it's unbelievable they're making that.
September, right?
Yeah, nobody's going to care. Nobody's going to watch it.
Well, yeah, I asked because I have no idea what's going on, because there's no like MCU news at all, but I saw some post-2026 where they're making Avengers again, and I'm like, well... Apparently, Wolverine's going to fight the Hulk in this movie in Deadpool.
There's a lot of speculation of particular cameos.
Fucking cool.
There's going to be all kind of wacky stuff in this one, but it's not an MCU movie. It's just like its own disconnected thing. Yeah. So I'm sure it's going to be fine. Like, I think it'll do well financially.
It'll snatch some MCU continuity, right? Like with the TVA, but we'll have to see what this ends up being. But to me, yeah, it could very well be successful just in the way that No Way Home and Guardians of the Galaxy 3 were, but that it won't help at all for the MCU.
Yeah.
You know what's weird is that to this day I get comments on, I'd made a video about Marvel Phase 4, and I get so often a comment that says, Loki was actually great. You're wrong about Loki. And I get that a lot.
Low people loved Loki. Do you remember when WandaVision came out? That was pretty well liked. A lot of people turned on it toward the second half. Falcon the Winter Soldier, that was much easier to be critical of, but there was still plenty of people defending the shit out of that. Loki was a big splitter. That was the one that we over at EFAP decided the MCU had died. Like, Loki had killed it with the they completely annihilated the stakes of the entire first set of phases with the stones being in the drawer. It's insults. Oh,
yeah. Loki getting knocked out as well by a random TVA agent.
Well, and it has one of the biggest insults to the concept of character development. Loki is reverted back to his villain form in Avengers, which is possibly the most villainous he ever was, and he watches a movie of his development in the MCU to turn back into the Loki we're familiar with. That was embarrassing.
And he cries while it's going on.
It's some of the worst shit I've ever seen. That's like the memory store level shit where you're just like, what the fuck are you doing? You can't write like this. And and then you guys know the rest of the story. All the movies just got worse and worse and worse and worse.
Yeah. And then also, we have the Loki was so boring. It was so slow paced. And
do you see season two?
Oh no, I didn't.
It was arguably worse.
Really?
Yeah, nobody saw that one. People stayed out. I think Loki is considered one of the better things that happened in Phase 4, but I don't think anyone's rewatching it.
I think the only show that I thought, oh wow, they put a bit of creativity into this one was WandaVision. And that was the first half of it, and then it just evolved into the usual Marvel sludge by the end. But initially it was quite imaginative.
I was quite impressed. I thought it was really cool they were using the like 4:3 black and white, even sound effects and all kinds of shit to really play with that era and to match it in terms of what her grief is and what she's going through. I was like, you know what? This is creative. This is bold. This is cool. But transitionally, as you go through the season, it eventually becomes giant special effects monsters firing lasers at each other and nothing makes any fucking sense. It was really sad to watch.
I wish they had just kept it kind of a personal story and not made it that she was accidentally enslaving a whole
how cool would it have been
town.
Yeah,
it's a psychosis she's got just with her, and that Doctor Strange is trying to break through to her. That's happening ultimately.
That would have been such a great story. In the same way that Logan was such a deep look into Wolverine's character, it could have been just that. Is that how does a superhero who can literally alter reality, how does she deal with a huge loss? I think that would have been great. They just made it. They made it too perverse, and then tried to justify her reasoning of enslavement. Oh God, it was just too awful.
If you won't let us go, just let us die. That was an actual line. In that.
And then,
you'll never know what you sacrificed for them.
Just terrible. Oh God,
it's such a disaster. Yeah, and that's the thing, because there's so much potential to use TV as allegory for how she's dealing with ignoring the loss of her loved one, right? Like creating a show where she's happily married with him. So good. And then, Kevin Feige said we can't be bringing in Doctor Strange, kind of a white man saving the day and stuff. And it's like, that's not even at all how you should be looking at this. He's a magic user who's trying to save her from her own grief. And he could easily pull on what he's been through in his life. Something that really bothered me is people being like, what would Doctor Strange even know? And it's like, that man died like 1,000 times to save the universe. But
yeah. Yeah, he's just a white man. What does he know
about innocence? It's so boring. And it was the beginning of the end, in a sense, right? Because, well, the end game, a lot of people say, is the beginning of the end, because the writing in that was pretty horrendous. But latest thing was the Marvels. You're not going to catch anyone recommending that.
Any Spider-Man projects coming out?
Nope. Well, you'll have Beyond the Spider-Verse in 2 years or whatever, probably.
No, I mean like...
not in the MCU, no.
Tobey Maguire.
Spider-Man 4, I heard.
That, I think there's rumors. I don't know if we've got anything on that yet. Okay. Well, it might be eventually. I mean, I agree with Gary that a Tobey Maguire, Sam Raimi, Spider-Man 4 is money on the table.
God, that's all it's going to be now. It's like bringing back these
Yeah, but...
You know, retirement age actors.
But there's a story to tell there, like an older Tobey Maguire Spider-Man has to
follow. Big story. I get it, but it's like it's literally just playing on the nostalgia. Like, yeah, sure, there is potentially a story to tell, but like ultimately you're going to get people to watch it just because it's Tobey Maguire, or Hugh Jackman playing Wolverine again for the first time in years. Like that's all it is, really.
I thought No Way Home was going to be, but it was a good balance of moving the future forward, but also having some elements of nostalgia.
Have you guys been watching The Boys?
No, I'm done with that.
Really?
I've got no interest in it at this point. It was already devolving into just shock value, like how gross or whatever can we make it?
And yeah,
how overtly political do we want to get? Like extremely, as it turns out, and it became less and less fun as time went on. I just kind of lost interest.
Yeah,
and yeah. Apparently,
season four is just a fucking disaster.
Oh, dude. Yeah, I'm just holding on because I just want to see Homelander finally do something. But
it's just, people have been saying that since season one.
Literally, he just doesn't do anything. It's like the most we got of him was that one vision he had where he like mowed down the entire mob.
You're not going to get anything until the final season, probably, because the way they do it, it's like a bait and switch sort of situation. Yeah. They're like, he's going to kill the whole world. And then they go, actually, we have this. And he's like, oh, I won't then. Next season, you know what? I don't even care that you have that. I'm going to kill the whole world. They're like, but we have this. And he's like, oh, shit. Okay, yeah, you have that. Repeat.
Have you read the comics?
I'm aware of the storyline, thanks to Gary.
So where's Soldier Boy? Is he coming back?
Well, I don't know why the fuck they didn't bring him back, because everyone loved Jensen Ackles as Soldier Boy.
Yeah.
I watched season 3 so I could stay up to date on like what the story was. I wasn't particularly invested, but I thought it was better than season 2. That could be controversial, I don't know. But I thought that his performance was pretty fun, and I don't know why the fuck they didn't bring him back. You may as well.
I don't know. It's like suicide of your own franchise, like what they did with Marvel. Like they could have just... They had the best thing going, man, with all the Avengers. They just stopped and they fired the Russo brothers or whatever, and it's just like completely taken a different direction.
They got fired? Yeah. I didn't know that.
Well, whatever, let go, or they're not working with them anymore. Same shit, I guess. It's like,
makes sense.
I remember reading something about how they asked if they could return, and they were told no. I don't know if that's true, though.
I think they said that they wouldn't return because they something with Kevin Feige, or am I wrong?
Don't know. There's a lot of... The problem with Marvel and Star Wars is the rumor mill is insanely...
Yeah, it's whatever's online.
This I can totally buy. Kripke didn't like the Soldier Boy became a fan favorite. He thought people would hate the character.
Well, so he is a monster, much like every character in fucking The Boys, but he's played extremely well, and
this is the thing, like, it's possible to like a villainous character without actually agreeing with the things they do. It's just because, like, they're played by a charismatic actor, or they're well written, they're interesting, they get to do like crazy stuff or whatever. Those are all reasons why you might like them. It doesn't mean you support them, and this is the funny thing with guys like Eric Kripke, who just can't handle the fact that like people might warm to some of these characters. And it's like, no, we need to make it more overt, damn it. We need to pander harder. Like that's all it becomes. And it's like, he's so fucking mad that people are turning against this stuff. It's kind of hilarious to watch, because it's like he's mad at his own audience.
Yeah.
Why don't you just do the things I tell you to do, damn it? Snex says, I had a talk with someone telling me how he likes Disney Star Wars, including the Acolyte. I tried to explain the bad writing, characters, and acting, but he said he still likes it with a big smile. Some people just like the jingling keys. I mean, I guess, like, what keys do you even jangle in the Acolyte's case? There's nothing there.
Key other than lightsabers, I guess.
I mean, I think maybe you just have to concede that your friend's just fucking retarded. Like, he sees lightsabers and he just smiles, I guess. Like, fine. Lost says, Star Wars is frustrating because aliens are just people with different color paint. There's no ideas, no different views or different cultures. Ahsoka is just orange. Yeah. That's exactly right, actually. Fuck.
Very true.
There's no variety of anything.
Certainly not.
Andor was the best, was probably the best example of like, oh, I get the feeling that there's different cultures here. You know, you're showing us like rituals that people go through and stuff.
The what was it called? The Eye of Andari or Andara or something like that. The ritual and sequence with the comets and shit.
Yeah,
that was awesome.
Shake from Hunger Team says, "Oh wait, I think I'm in Oz. I just got these shoes, but I don't have feet. Drinker is the Tin Man. MauLer is the Scarecrow, and Baggage Claim is the Lion." wow. I don't want to be the Tin Man.
What, wouldn't I be Tin Man?
Yeah, you don't have a heart.
Yeah. I'll be Tin Man.
I'll be Scarecrow because I don't have a brain. And yeah.
The fuck am I? The flying monkeys? Like,
someone's going to be the Cowardly Lion.
You could be the Yellow Brick Road.
I could be the guy behind the veil or the curtain or whatever.
John Doe, the average Joe, says the Brendock Stone Castle was originally fire retardant, but it had to prove it was brighter than witches and acolyte writers after hearing the power of many. Well, yeah. I think it combusted out of sheer rage.
I think I'm going to turn that song into my ring, my phone ring.
Shit. DeVal says, just like The Witcher Season 3 episode that kept repeating the same scene over again. Yeah, they had one like that, didn't they? It was just the same thing from different camera angles. Inferior says, saw your last Boys video. People called it a review where you didn't watch the thing, even though the video seemed more like a meta commentary. Yeah, that's exactly what it was. I mean, I specifically said in my video, I'm not going to watch it because it doesn't seem like my thing anymore. I'm just commenting on the fan backlash to it. I don't know, man. People got big mad about that video. Like, how dare you criticize the Boys in any way? I don't know, man.
No, I mean, can you even say anything these days about people being big mad? That feels like the culture we're in.
I don't know. Like, I'm just like, I'm seeing the fucking audience score, which is like 50% or something, where every other season has been like 70 or 80 or above. I'm seeing all the fan backlash to it, and I'm seeing like the showrunners straight up berating the fans for not like thinking the same way they do. And I thought I'd make a video comment on that stuff. So I guess that was wrong and I shouldn't have done that. So sorry, world. Fearless Wolf says, Drinker, my fellow countryman, are you a Celtic or a Rangers fan, or do you prefer synchronized swimming? Swimming, for sure, because I don't come from Glasgow, so I'm not really going to support Rangers or Celtic in that case. So that's probably the reason then there. A rapidly deflating air mattress says, imagine how mad Bridgerton fans would be if they stuck a bunch of gun battles in the next season. That's how we feel about Leslie Headland in Star Wars. Indeed.
Fair point.
And Andre says, hi, everyone. Gladiator 2 is more woke crap. The slaves taking over Rome, a.k.a. the rich are evil and corrupted and will die at the hands of the social justice gladiators. Total garbage. Acolyte is official Star Wars lesbian porn. So I have no idea whether you would class Gladiator 2 as being woke or anything like that. Rome, towards the end of its reign, I suppose, as the preeminent superpower in Europe, was corrupt and did get overthrown from political turmoil within and like conquered from without. So maybe that's what they're going for here. I don't know yet. I can't really make any, you know, I can't make any judgments from the trailer. It just seems like a fairly shitty, generic action movie set in Rome. So Ridley Scott doesn't seem like that kind of director either. So I wouldn't expect too much on that front.
Yeah.
But what I will probably do is finish up there because we've been going for about like 2.5 hours. And my panel, I want to say, thank you to you guys for coming in for this tonight. Yeah. It's been
awesome. Thank you for the invite.
Yeah, thank you for having us. It's great.
Of course. Theory,
I want to say thank you to you for the Theory Saber as well. I can definitely recommend it for people who are interested in buying like a display lightsaber that will actually, it'll do all the light-y up stuff as well. And you you know, you can fight people with it or whatever you want to do, but it's good stuff. And the link is in the description.
I got my Dooku one, and it was beautiful. It was everything.
Has your son whacked you with it yet?
I just like to chase the dogs around the garden with it. Like, come here! Turns out greyhounds are quite fast.
Go to your room, no, Dad.
Yeah. And Baggage Claim, thank you for coming on. It's been great to have you back on the Open Bar.
Thank you so much.
We were going to have you on several weeks ago, actually, but I think you were tied up with other commitments, so you couldn't quite make it at the time, but glad we got you on in the end.
Yeah, me too. And it gave me a reason to watch Acolyte, which I was resisting massively. So thank you for that reason.
Yeah, I'm sure you're really grateful that we made you watch this show.
Hey, now I can make content out of it. Why not?
That is true, yeah.
And with one episode of The Acolyte left, that means only one thing. Our show is returning. Stargrift.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The return of Stargrift.
The return of Stargrift for one episode, and then that's it.
Yeah. Well, you've got, like, what, it'll 8 entire episodes to cover with that.
That'll be a long one. It'll be good.
We'll finally know the full story of the season.
Yep.
Yeah.
Maybe from another angle.
Maybe we'll love it.
Episode 7. Yeah.
Maybe we will love it.
It'll make sense of everything. Like, imagine that. Like, somehow it makes sense of everything. It turns it into, like, the best Star Wars show ever made. Like
imagine they say, like, the rocks are actually sentient and they're actually the true victims because they got burned in this whole story. And now it's their perspective. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. They were the oppressed.
Yeah.
Damn it. Why did we make an entire fortress out of 1990s shell suits? Anyway. I will finish up there, but thank you, guys. Appreciate everyone who's super chatted us and joined us for this this little open bar this evening. And as always, we will cover any of the super chats that we missed on Last Orders. For now, that's all we got for today. So go away now.
Bye.